Episode number 422 here is going to be brought to you by a couple different products. The first one is from Sir Thrival. And if you guys aren't familiar with Daniel Vitalis and his products over there, he is, he's been on our show multiple times. Really great guy. Really support the work that he does. He really takes it to another level with his products. He's got the Shazandra berry, which contains all 5 flavors. It's incredible superfood. He's got the pine pollen, which I love, which is great for hormones. He's got that multiple different forms too, like the powder form and pills if you're traveling, which are great, and dual extracted tinctures. Pine pollen's really great for your hormones. He's got the colostrum, which is great for building your immune system and rebuilding your gut lining. It's incredible food, as well as the mushrooms, medicinal mushrooms, dual extracted. Go over to Sir Thrival and check out their products, and there'll be a link on this page. Make sure to do that. He's got some really great stuff too. He's got lots of really cool stuff there that I love, and we buy from Daniel quite frequently. He's been a guest on our show a number of different times. So check that out. And this show is also brought to you by our friends over at Mountain Rose Herbs. This is where we get, oh my gosh, we get so much stuff from Mountain Rose Herbs. We love their stuff, and they have the best prices too, because they're bulk prices, and so they're really, really cheap, but everything's organic, grown in pristine environments. And they have, if you want to make reishi, we get a lot of reishi and shaga from there when we want to make our own teas, when we don't get it from Daniel. And they have everything there, bulk spices, herbs, and teas. If you really want to get into medicinal mushrooms and the longevity aspect of medicinal mushrooms, Mountain Rose Herbs is the place to get all of your stuff. And they've got herbs and spices, different teas, all kinds of really great stuff, bath and body containers, all kinds of really cool stuff over at Mountain Rose Herbs. And they have, like I said before, the best prices on bulk herbs and spices that you're going to find on the internet, and the highest quality as well. So go over to, if you want, the best place to go and get these both these items is extremehealthradio.com/422, and they'll also be available in our store as well. So again, that's extremehealthradio.com/422, and there'll be links on that page to Mountain Rose Herbs and Sir Thrival. All right, with that said, let's get on with the show. The hardest thing is making sure you don't roll over her on your chair.
Oh, you know? Oh yeah, no, I'm very, because Yoshi used to be in our office. We have like little chairs on the desk, and he would be wrapped around those wheels. So I would tell my husband, and my husband would be so careful, because yeah, this little paw.
Okay, we're live.
We are live.
All right. Thanks to you, everybody, for joining us on Extreme Health Radio. I hope that all of you guys can hear us. Please let us know if you're in the chat room and you can hear us or not. We had some technical issues starting out the show today because we're actually going to be moving studios. So we'll talk about that in a later podcast.
At a later time.
But if you guys are in the chat room and you can let us know if you can hear us, that would be amazing. Please type in that you can, and that would be great. Today, we have Sandhiya Ramaswamy in the studio.
I have to say, best name ever.
Best name ever.
You win the best name award. It's so cool.
And we are going to be talking about Ayurveda, and I think I broke one of the fundamental Ayurvedic principles. I had cold fruit for breakfast this morning. I think that was too good. I had cold papaya, and then afterwards I had tea, and the tea just...
Well, you know, you did antidote it. That's the principle of Ayurveda. And if you had put some lemon juice and some salt and pepper on the papaya, you're golden.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the temperature of the food matters.
Temperature of the food matters for digestion. And I always say, you know, how is it working out for you? So if you're having cold fruit for breakfast and you don't have any digestive issues or any other issues, you're golden.
Okay.
So it's not a one-size-fits-all. So that's the beauty of Ayurveda.
Yeah. Mm. So. I've been really, really drawn to Ayurvedic principles. And I think that I think there's something there. So what do you think? First of all, I should tell people who you are. Sandhiya Ramaswamy, first of all, how did you guys meet?
Well, this is really cool. Last was it October?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. Yeah. In That's the fall, right. there was a first of what is hopefully going to be an annual right. women's event called Mindful Her.
Okay.
I didn't see any men there, did you?
No,
there
no.
weren't many men there. Right. Mindful
although
Her.
They, although they did have a couple's retreat on
oh,
Valentine's Day.
Oh, they
yes.
did.
Mm-hmm.
Well, good for them.
Yes, yes.
And it's really exciting because Sandhiya and I have a mutual friend that just lives right down our street. Mm-hmm. And our friend Krista introduced us. And it was actually an interesting story. I think I might have told you this at the conference. But there was a pamphlet that I had seen at our health food store mm-hmm. at Mother's Market.
Okay.
And it said Mindful Her. It had the dates, all these things about 6 months prior. And mm-hmm. I picked it up. It sat on my desk uh-huh. for the whole 6 months. Mm-hmm. And I thought, I just don't have the extra cash. It wasn't mm-hmm. that expensive, but mm-hmm. I was on a tight budget.
Sure.
And I just said, this is something I really want to do. I just don't know. Mm-hmm. So Krista, the day before, I believe it was, the conference, she texted me and said, hey, Kate, my friend Sandhiya invited me and a friend to come to this conference as her guest because she's going to be doing a talk on Ayurveda and oils and essential oils and things like that. Mm-hmm. She goes, do you want to go with me? My mouth, literally, my jaw just dropped. And I thought, nice. Wow, I put it out to the universe
yes.
and it sent it back to me. And so I was
yes.
able to attend the conference and yes. we were able to hear Sandhiya speak. And I have to say, in that what, half hour, 40, maybe
yeah,
an hour?
But I did an aromatherapy. Yeah,
I learned
right.
more about Ayurveda than I had ever heard. And we'd had a few people on the show talk about Ayurveda, but not to this extent. So
wow. yeah.
it was powerful.
Yeah, it was so lovely to meet you. Aww. It was such a magical day that day.
It was a magical day.
Yeah, and how you got there was even more magical.
I'm still like scratching my head going, this is how it all works?
Yeah.
This is so funny.
Yeah, and seeing Krista after a long time, it was wonderful.
Reconnecting. So
yeah.
thank you for having me as your guest, and thank
oh.
you for being our guest
thank
today
you.
On our show.
Thank, yeah. thank
oh
you.
Return the favor.
Thank
and
you both of you
yeah.
for
we're
having
excited.
Me. I'm so
fun.
Close to my heart, and so
yeah.
Yes. I'm very excited to share it with the world. So,
so it says here, I was reading your bio,
yeah.
and golly, you do Panchakarma, and you're a Panchakarma specialist, clinical
right.
Ayurvedic specialist.
Right.
You have a place in Dana Point called Green Lotus Wellness.
That's right.
What is Panchakarma for people that don't know?
Panchakarma literally means, pancha means five, karma
okay.
means action. So it's really the five therapeutic cleansing actions. So
okay.
Ayurveda is the ultimate science or medicine of prevention as well.
Okay.
And there's a whole, branch of Ayurveda that deals with what we call rasayana or rejuvenation therapies.
Okay.
So ideally in ancient India, well, this happens even nowadays in India and other parts of the world, people would literally retreat during spring and fall, during the change of seasons.
Average people or people that are into health?
Well, in the olden days, it used to be a way of living, so it would be everybody.
Wow.
Oh.
And now we've all gotten away from our roots, right?
Okay.
I mean, we all used to live Ayurvedically 3 or 4 generations ago.
Now we're eating McDonald's.
Yeah, yeah. And so
gone are those days.
Yeah, so they would retreat where they would literally go for 10, 15 days, maybe a month, get all these therapies done, and also it would be a great time for them to pause and reflect and do some inner work as well.
This
and
would
then,
be twice a year?
This would be ideally done twice a year, or at least oh. once a year. And so that's what I would encourage people to do, even in the comfort of their own home. That's why we see the popularity of cleanses and
mm-hmm.
spring rejuvenation, and even, you know, even a mild detox you can do in the comfort of your home.
Would people do this in India as a family, or would they go off separately by themselves?
Good question.
How would they do that?
It would depend. It would depend. I mean, things have changed so much now. India now
yeah.
more resembles the West.
Yeah.
We do have lovely retreat and resort places, but it's more, you know, more the adults.
Okay.
You know, but again, India is such a family culture as well.
Mm-hmm.
So many of the retreats also cater to, you know, childcare and things like that. While, you know, maybe the parents are.
Isn't that interesting that people
mm-hmm.
would do that and just mm-hmm. as a way of sort of maintenance, you know?
Yeah, the Japanese mm-hmm. culture has a similar, they have a similar tradition.
Do they?
Yeah, of retreating to, I can't remember what they're called, but these health spas.
Wow.
To, yeah, yeah. I mean,
rejuvenate.
And it's good to see that culture kind of coming up
mm-hmm.
here, but I think it needs to be perhaps be more and more democratic.
Yeah.
Again, to your point, you
right.
know, not, you know, shell out $5,000 on a weekend retreat. Yeah, but there are some good retreats. I personally have been to Soshone in the mountains of Colorado, which is a wonderful yoga.
What is it called?
Soshone, S-O-S-H-O-N-I.
Okay.
And they offer lovely yoga retreats along with Ayurveda therapies. My college, California College of Ayurveda, has a wonderful Panchakarma Center as well.
And so I've often heard Panchakarma just in reference to like oil cleansing and saunas and stuff like that. But it's much more than that, right?
Oh, it's much more than
that.
Whole thing. Yeah, it's a whole thing. I have someone coming for a 3-day Panchakarma next week. And so, you know, our goal is to make this as much as a retreat as possible.
So when you said you have someone coming, so they're coming to you to go through this?
Through the body therapies, but I put them on a very strict protocol for 10 days.
Okay.
So 4 days prior to it, 3-day protocol of body therapies, and 3 days prior to that, so full 10-day protocol where they're eating a mono diet of khichdi, which is considered the perfect food in Ayurveda.
What is it called?
What is
khichdi? It's a perfect mix of basmati rice and a special type of lentils called mung beans with spices. And so it's easily digestible, but offers great nutrition as well.
So they eat the mono diet, is it always that, or is it sometimes something different, mono diet?
There is not much variation. You're kind of giving your digestive system a break to do the detoxification, you know. Okay. So you're kind of simplifying things. And you're also kind of looking inward. The whole object of Panchakarma retreat is to kind of go inward, to pause, so that your senses are not going outward towards, oh, what should I eat? What should I eat for lunch? What can I eat for dinner? And so you're becoming more mindful. And so, they eat a mono diet of khichdi. They have certain supplements, herbs, digestive teas that they take. So so the goal is to, this is kind of, I call it retreat in your own backyard, if you will. And
I
encourage
that.
Them to, we usually plan this well ahead, like at least 3 or 4 months in advance, depending on the, you know, client's schedule, so that they can clear out their schedule. Because there's no point in working a full 8-10 hour day and coming to me to do Panchakarma in the evening and kind of going back to a full day.
Right.
So
right.
when they do that, if they do work, let's say they work part-time and they got to go to a job or something, would they take that food with them and they would do it?
Absolutely. Exactly. In a thermos. Yeah. So they would make it perhaps the night before and heat it on the stove in the morning. Not in the microwave, and then put it in their little thermos and eat. Yes, exactly. And I've done it myself. I've done cleanses when I was working. As you know, this is my second avatar. I come from the corporate world.
Oh, right, right,
I knew this,
So, and it can be done.
So tell people about just a little bit about what your corporate world experience was like.
Right. So I like to say I'm a, you know, controller turned Ayurveda practitioner. So I got my MBA in finance. Let me back up. My passion was cooking since I was 9 or 10 years old.
So your real passion is that.
My mother's kitchen. And that's what I love to do. And so I went to a culinary school, 3 years of culinary school
in
India, got trained as a chef, and came to Purdue in Indiana to finish up my 4th year. And I finished my 4th year and I was interviewing with, resorts and, food companies, and I got a couple of offers. But in the meantime, I told myself, I had an internal dialogue with myself. Much as my parents supported me in following my passion, I kind of told myself, I have many members in my family who are doctors and lawyers and engineers. I'm just going to take the GMAT, which is the entrance exam to MBA programs. I said, if I score well, let's see where this goes. And
I'm just going to take it for fun.
I'm just going to take it. And I scored, well enough to get full assistantship to a couple of universities for the MBA program. And so and Ohio State was one of them. And so I did my MBA in finance and marketing, and I kind of detoured into the world of corporate America for 15 years after that.
Wow.
And I like to say, as my health kept, as I kept climbing the corporate ladder, my health kept bottoming out because I was born with asthma. I've had chronic asthma since I was a baby, and frequent emergency room visits, and the straw that broke the camel's back was landing up in the hospital with pneumonia.
Really?
Yeah, and it was touch and go, and it was a wake-up call, and I decided that I need to take charge of my health.
So was that Did that coincide with the time in your life when you were really focused on the corporate ladder? And
absolutely. Yeah. I kind of downsized a little bit in the sense that I did request a transfer to a warm weather location. Mm-hmm. We used to live in Chicago back then. Oh, so I was very happy to move to my job here. First job here in California was in Irvine.
Okay.
I was a little warmer
than Chicago.
A little warmer than Chicago.
A little bit warmer.
And yeah, and I worked for the likes of the company that brought me here was Kraft Foods.
Oh my goodness.
So I worked for the, and then I worked for Heinz Ketchup. So I worked for the processed food company giants.
Wow.
Yeah.
You couldn't be any more opposite.
And then you saw the light.
And then I saw the light. I had to take charge of my health, found an Ayurveda practitioner for the first time, built immunity with her help. And I saw how empowering this way of life is. Ayurveda is a way of life.
Yeah, it's not just a diet.
It's not a diet. It's everything. You know, it's a way of living, much like yoga is.
So how did you... Okay, can we get just a picture of her?
Absolutely, yep.
For our Instagram
link? I got it.
It's tech.
What happened when you're in the hospital with pneumonia?
Yeah.
And then, so how did you come out of, did you get healthy enough to leave the hospital? And then that's when you saw the.
And you know, pneumonia is a kind of condition where recovery time is 2 to 3 months to get status quo. Yes, it debilitates you. So, my 75-year-old aunt actually flew from Atlanta to kind of help me out as well.
Oh my through goodness.
So, it was that serious. but it was such a wake up call because, again, I have the highest regard for Western medicine, conventional medicine.
Right.
I think it has its place.
Right.
And it has personally helped me or perhaps even saved my life.
Yeah, yeah.
At least 2 to 3 times.
Mm.
But it is very much a disease care medicine,
mm-hmm.
i.e. it treats the symptoms and not the root cause.
Right.
Right. And so it was especially scary when they said that I need to go on a long-term dose or a long-term a long-term protocol of prednisone,
which
is such a serious steroid with whole host of side effects. And I realized they can only give me another medication, another inhaler, another antibiotic to treat the symptom but not treat the root cause. And I decided to get back to my roots of Ayurveda, which my mother, my grandmother would practice. But we would not, we had not fully embraced Ayurveda though. We still would go to the Western educated MD.
Yeah.
You know, so I decided to really, you know, give it a shot. I picked up a book on Ayurveda, but not wanting to do things, half-assed, so to speak.
Yeah.
I decided I sought out a practitioner.
Uh-huh.
And I saw Ayurveda was so much more than herbs and oils. Like, you know, we were talking, it's a way of life.
It's a whole spiritual way of life.
Mind, body, spirit, customized for you.
Mm-hmm.
There is no other system of medicines that's customized. And so I started building immunity, feeling better, managing the symptoms of my asthma and other conditions that I had as well. And I wanted to learn more.
Mm-hmm.
And then I researched colleges and programs, Ayurveda programs in this country. California College of Ayurveda at that time had a little location, a small strip mall location in Cerritos in,
good old Cerritos.
Little Cerritos, right? I don't know, is it Orange County or LA County?
I think it's LA County.
LA County, mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it is in Little India.
Oh my gosh.
So, yeah, and I decided I want to learn more. Just not with the objective of leaving my day job.
Mm-hmm.
Just I want to learn more. And that was in 2008. I stepped foot into the school in January of 2008. And I have to say, I haven't looked back because I didn't know how much Ayurveda was working on me. I like to say Ayurveda helps you achieve the highest potentials and levels of mind, body, spirit, health.
Mm-hmm.
And literally, it makes you live an authentic life. And so I went to school there and they asked me if I would audition to be a teacher. I started teaching.
Wow.
And then when I started seeing patients as part of my internship, that was my aha moment.
Mm.
When I started seeing how simple recommendations based on their constitution made such a profound impact on their health and well-being and their families, it was very clear to me that this was my dharma from this point on. So... Yeah,
it's interesting. What I like about so much Ayurveda is just the individualized idea of looking at someone and people think doshas and they think just body type, but even dosha is much more than just Yeah. How you walk, how you think. It's right. A lot more than just
it's,
that,
it's,
right?
Yeah, it's mind-body type. It's personality characteristics. So, yeah, even before somebody comes to see me, and this is true of pretty much every Ayurveda practitioner who practices in this methodology, I send a very detailed questionnaire, 11-page questionnaire, to understand the full person.
Wow.
And the initial meeting, we call it the initial intake appointment, lasts about 2 hours.
Wow. So this is after they've filled out all
the paperwork. So, yeah. So I've already reviewed the paperwork, and I'm asking questions, and wow. I'm seeking clarifications. I'm doing a physical evaluation, evaluating the tongue, evaluating the pulse. Mm-hmm. They give me clues as to who this person is, mm-hmm. so yeah. that the treatment program can be wholly customized to this person.
Our mutual friend Krista had said when we went to your talk, she said, I have never felt like I covered so much ground and mm-hmm. gained such giant leaps mm-hmm. in her health as when mm-hmm. she went with you mm-hmm. and did the Ayurveda. And she said, right. honestly, it was hours of looking at her as a whole right. human, and she said she just never had experienced anything like that in her life.
Yeah, I mean,
we're not used to that in this culture, you know,
like
somebody caring enough about us to spend this amount of time
right.
looking at us
right.
and assessing us. And
right,
and I bet you see miracles.
It is. I mean, that's what Ayurveda did for me. You know, I think Ayurveda finally gives us a language or lens to be able to understand who we are. And the Ayurveda practitioner is just a facilitator. The healing happens because the patient wants to heal, and the patient is empowered, and they are taking steps. I like to say I talk the talk, and you know, my patients walk the walk.
Much they walk the walk.
When I was working with my Ayurveda practitioner, Nima Berenji, who's a wonderful practitioner. So it's really empowering, and it gives you a way of living that is in keeping with who you are.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Have you had complete skeptics come in, I'm sure, and be like, oh, I've tried everything. This isn't going to work for me. And then completely seen their eyes light up when they realize that they've been able to receive some help they didn't see coming?
Yeah. You know, the one thing I hear over and over again, and this is my take on Ayurveda, it's common sense.
It's common sense.
It's common sense. When it's cold outside, you know, when it's a cold, blustery winter night.
Don't eat cold mango in the morning.
Exactly. Or don't eat a cold salad. Have a nice warm bowl of soup, carrot right. soup, you know, spiced with ginger and nutmeg.
That yeah. makes sense.
There you go.
It makes
yeah.
a lot of sense.
Right.
It's common sense.
It is
so
common
it's no
sense.
Mumbo. It's not mumbo jumbo. And I say it's not new age medicine. You know, it's kind of now age medicine. It's, you know, it's appropriate for who we are in the time we are living.
So what happens when people, because for the longest time I did, I don't know if you can tell anything about my dosha now, but I did raw food for 7 years and you know, that's cold and damp and, you know, and so it's funny, I'm clearing my throat now because of that. I think it's I had started having to clear my throat after I ate that fruit, that cold fruit. But so what happens when people eat a diet that's improper for their dosha?
Oh, I always say, you know, how is it working out for you? And I, especially digestive disturbances or canaries in the coal mine. I've had patients who have, you know, raw food enthusiasts, vegan enthusiasts, eating the highest quality, what I call high prana. High life force energy food, organic, locally grown, seasonal. They're doing all that, but they're having gas, constipation, bloating, diarrhea. Mm-hmm. Those are indications that your digestion is not optimized. So in Ayurveda, we have a caveat. It's not so much you are what you eat, it's you are how you digest. Digestion is the single most important determinant of good health and immunity.
So when someone is eating improperly for their body type or dosha, over time, is that creating mucus in the body, do you think? Or is it creating an imbalance somewhere?
In Ayurveda, we have this concept called ama or toxin and mucus, excess mucus, which is not required for protection and lubrication. Yes, could be one type of ama, definitely. So going back to digestion, if we are digesting well, we need to be producing from our food. So what's the end goal of eating, right? Apart from enjoyment of food.
Nutrition.
Nutrition, right? Energy, stamina. Uh-huh. Immunity, what we call ojas in Ayurveda.
I've heard that.
Ojas.
They said it in yoga, right?
Yes.
Don't they say that? I've heard that. In
I've heard that too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know why.
OJAS.
OJAS. OJAS.
So if digestion is optimized, food equals OJAS.
Okay.
If digestion is not optimized, we are creating AMA, which is toxic buildup. And, you know, again, modern science has confirmed the importance of digestive health, right? We've seen the proliferation of the probiotic industry for, I don't know, what, the past 10, 15 years?
It's been, yeah,
it's massive. Been huge. Yeah. And, you know, I remember listening to a talk by one of, you know, one of the leading Ayurveda doctors in this country, you know, John Duyard, you know, who's talking about how most of our lymphatic system, which is the body's like plumbing system closely associated with the immune system, it lines the, you know, the villi, the finger-like projections in our small intestine.
It lines it.
It lines it. So, yeah, any impairments in the gut, you know, or any impairment in the digestion, if you have digestive issues, you know, causes, causes the lymphatic system to not be able to drain or work as efficiently.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, and
I always thought lymphatics were sort of here and you're
everywhere,
like that. But
everywhere.
Everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Huh. But yeah, that was eye opening for me when you know John was talking about digestive health and and it's called gut associated lymphatic tissue.
Gut-associated lymphatic tissue.
GALT, for GALT, short.
Okay. GALT.
So I always tell people, pay attention. You know, okay, if you're having, you know, okay, you had maybe spicy Indian food, Thai food, Mexican food, you had heartburn one day. It happens maybe once a year. Okay, may not be as much as
make
an
a note
issue.
Of that. Yeah.
Make a note of it. But if it's something that's happening more often, more frequent, anything, any digestive issues, that's your body trying to tell you something. Our bodies are so intelligent. We have such innate intelligence. And, you know, Ayurveda is the process of awakening our own potential to heal. That's about
so
it.
So for I some people, that. Though, mm-hmm. The raw food from an Ayurvedic perspective would be a good thing because they're those, what are those, what's the body type that's really big and fiery?
Oh, pitta.
So for them to balance out, maybe
depends.
A little bit of raw.
Sure. On a hot summer day, for somebody who has a lot of fire in their constitution, let's say
something
they
like
want to enjoy like an Indian meal, they would do well to enjoy it with maybe a side of coconut water and a nice cucumber salad with some cilantro on top. These are nice cooling foods.
But you have to know
the balance.
Yes.
Balance.
And I always say, how is it working out for you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, come back to
for
symptoms.
You.
Be honest.
Yeah.
Be honest.
Yeah.
How is it really working out?
Yeah.
We had someone in the chat room that has a few questions that we'll get to, but they asked in general, probiotics, what's your take on it? I mean, is it good that we're adding them in or are we supposed to be getting them from our food?
You know, I think if somebody has any digestive issues and if they are not, normally taking yogurt or kefir, I would say, probiotics are probably a good add to their diet.
Do a lot of folks come in with patients and they are on really rigid protocols with supplementation and things like that? Can that be part of their Ayurvedic experience, or do you encourage people to kind of level out, start over?
Yeah, and so I'm never having people, stop taking any supplements per se. I educate them on the pros and cons. Definitely, even with herbal supplementation, with Ayurvedic herbal supplementation, I make it very clear. They are going to build momentum and jumpstart the process in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But real change happens with change in diet and lifestyle. That's the cornerstone, more than any herbs or supplementation.
Mm-hmm.
And hey, I mean, I'm a big proponent. I say that your spice cabinet is your medicine cabinet.
Mm-hmm.
So all my recipes include lots of spices and herbs. Well, we can use them as food.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, spices
right.
are, I've listened to a few different doctors talk about spices. People have written entire books and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Spices are some of the just the most incredible anti-cancer, anti-disease.
Exactly.
Anti-inflammatory.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, I love spices.
Yeah. So, again, like Hippocrates said, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, salt is good every now and then, but I don't know, something about spices and putting spices on everything. I'd love it.
Absolutely.
So good.
Absolutely.
Spice it up.
Yeah.
Be spicy.
Yeah. We'll do our next talk with some masala chai tea.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Tons of spices.
You would be a happy camper. Yeah, this is interesting. I want to know what you think about this question because this is probably a lot of people's questions out there about the grains. They say I went to see an Ayurvedic doctor and she told me she likes fruits and recommends me to eat fruits, mm-hmm. but fruits hurt my belly. I get belly aches at night. And she also says she likes khichdi, that has lots of grains. Mm-hmm. Can we ask her about how to heal the gut? What does she think about taking probiotics? Mm-hmm. I'm wondering about the whole, I mean, the fruit thing is interesting because, mm-hmm. again, I know it's not a one size fits all.
Right.
But so many people, like myself included, mm-hmm. were so grain free. We try to add mm-hmm. grains back in after a while. We mm-hmm. react really poorly. Are grains a good thing for people to heal? I mean, is basmati rice an okay thing for people who have had gut issues to...
It's basmati so against rice, like, oh. It has been revered in Ayurveda. So I always go back to what has worked for thousands of years, mm-hmm. right? So right. because to me, more than, you know, people ask, okay, is there clinical trials been done on the studies been... Well, it's only been like 5,000, 6,000 years of use, right? So... basmati rice is, you know, has some very unique, you know, quote unquote, I would say, you know, medicinal qualities in Ayurveda. It's very easy to digest. And I think studies have come out even on its glycemic index where they say it's not as bad as other white rice for people, you know, uh-huh. who may have, you know, borderline diabetes mm-hmm. or, you know, who are watching their sugar intake. Again, like you said, it's not a one-size-fits-all. And a moderate amount of grain. So, you know, we have different tastes of food in Ayurveda, right? So
get a little bit closer to the
mic. Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
We have different...
Or you can pull it closer,
Yeah. And again, I can't comment on this specific person because, you know, again, the Ayurveda assessment is very thorough.
Right.
Yeah. And I don't know the rationale for why she was recommended certain things, right? So there is this... there are six tastes of food in Ayurveda, and we try to match it up to the person's constitution, okay. right? One of the tastes of food in Ayurveda is the sweet taste. Sweet tasting foods, and by the way, foods affect us not just on a physical level, but on a psychological and emotional level as well. Sweet tasting foods include dairy, nuts, whole grains, and root vegetables, like
nuts.
Sweet,
nuts, I wouldn't.
Sweet potatoes and things like that, right?
It doesn't mean
and
you can't have them.
No. True. That's where I'm getting
part
to.
Of the sweet part, yeah.
Those are the healthy examples of sweet-tasting mm-hmm. food.
Okay.
And then you have the unhealthy examples of sweet-tasting foods, which are the pastries and the cookies and just the white sugar, the white processed flours, right? Yeah. So in this khichdi recipe, for instance, in my khichdi recipe, so I'm not sure what the khichdi recipe calls for, I would say, so I truly believe, and, you know, I think studies have shown, and again, I'm not a Western educated nutritionist. I'm an Ayurveda practitioner. Mm-hmm. But I think I've seen studies and research show that, you know, whole grains help the brain secrete the neurotransmitter serotonin, which is kind of like the feel-good hormone.
Right.
So sweet-tasting food make us feel grounded, make us feel satisfied, because they're made up of the elements of water and earth, which are the heaviest, densest, mm-hmm. right? Moist, yeah? So we need to have a fair amount of that in our diet, depending on our dosha, you know, especially if we are more airy and etheric, we need these grounding mm-hmm. foods. So, you know, to answer this person's question, you know, these are good examples of sweet tasting food. So it doesn't necessarily have to come from grains. But I truly believe like a small amount of grains, you know, small amount of high quality oatmeal in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
It's whole
you
grain oats, gluten free.
It's funny you say that because it's coming up a lot for us lately. Mm-hmm. Just hearing stories of the longevity factor with it, people that are really old and into their hundreds, and you
what's
ask them
what's the secret,
they do every
and they
morning.
Say oatmeal.
Mm-hmm. Oatmeal every morning. And,
right.
You know?
Right. Exactly. I mean, high fiber, again, least processed. So basmati rice, you know, coming from India, you know, it's, you know, it's very much like, I remember growing up, you know, my dad would travel. I'm from originally from South India. My dad would travel and it used to be a special treat. He would go to the area. It's basmati rice is grown in a specific area in the foothill of the Himalayas, and he would get this basmati rice from there. It was so fragrant and amazing.
The real rice.
The real rice. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and even Trader Joe's has organic basmati rice. Yeah.
We had a guest on our show a while back. He does a lot of work with like fermentation, and he does this thing called fermentation potential. I forgot what his name was. Robillard or
Robillard.
And he's listed all the grains and given them a fermentation potential reaction in the gut. And I believe that basmati rice was one of the lowest ones.
So, that makes sense. Yeah. That makes sense. But also along that lines to make grains. So when I do khichdi recipes, you know, I have more lentils and less of rice. So, you know, and so when I cook rice, I always make it with quinoa. To increase the oomph, if you will, right? Okay. Quinoa has high protein and fiber as well. But another thing I would totally recommend is soaking, pre-soaking. Of course, lentils and beans have to be soaked to improve their digestibility.
Yeah, you can't eat those without soaking.
No, but even rice. Soak it. If you have digestive issues, you know, you're making it more digestible.
So nuts too, probably, right? Yeah. Nuts.
How long would you soak? Would you just soak any rice?
Yeah, like especially I say aged basmati rice, which has been kind of aged for maybe 1 or 2 years. I would say minimum of 30 minutes.
Minimum. Oh, that's
And you'll see it. You will see it expand in my cooking classes. Like aha moment. You know, we started with the rice. I put this water and then it expands. It doubles in size.
Oh,
so
like
it needed
seeds,
the water.
They soak it right up.
And they're hydrophilic, right?
Right.
So they really soak up a lot of water.
It is cool to see that process.
Yeah.
It's not just this magical thing you think happens overnight.
Right.
To watch it is just incredible.
I mean, soaked almonds, having soaked almonds,
you do that
soaked
a lot.
And peeled almonds in the morning is an Ayurveda recipe for building ojas.
So. Mm.
You know, one of our guests, that's what his whole thing is, Adam Bergstrom.
Oh, yeah.
He talks about soaking almonds and doing almonds for breakfast every morning. What do you think about wild rice? I've heard a lot of people talk about wild rice.
I think it's actually a grass.
Is it?
Really? Yeah, it's actually a grass, I think. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I think it's very high in fiber. And again, if it's, you know, I've seen wild rices that were traditionally, you know, used by Native Americans. So again, closer we get to, you know, nature and things that are grown locally as well.
Yes.
I think they can. Yeah. And again.
Yeah.
They are more difficult to digest because they're very high in fiber. So again, you know, they're going to take longer to cook. Again, cook with spices.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cooking with spices always improves digestibility of pretty much anything.
Mm.
Yeah.
Really? So just any kind of spice?
For me, the rice, when I saute my rice, right? I mean, this is again an aha moment. Try just, you know, making rice on stovetop with water. It's fine. Basmati rice is fine, but saute the rice. So I like to saute it with cumin, cardamom, cinnamon, and cloves, and turmeric. I saute the rice, and then you hear a crackling noise, and then it's ready to meet the water. Then you add the water. It's just the grains stand separate. It's so much more yummy. And
you're making me hungry
now. I know. I'm like, gosh.
You're making me excited about rice.
Salivate. I know. Because I used to make a...
You should start doing some of that.
I did that exact same thing when I used to eat everything under the sun, but I used to saute with butter this white rice when I made a risotto.
There you go.
And then you add your broth.
Right.
But it was that crackling moment. I know what you're talking about, and it becomes opaque.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, it's ready.
Yeah.
Let's start doing
it's
that.
It's a dance.
Because we have
like
a bunch of ghee. That would be good to do.
We do have ghee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How would you do that?
We got to warm ourselves up. We eat too much cold.
Yeah.
We do eat too much cold.
Really?
And I know this. But
and it's weird
we need
because it's like, I just love it. You know,
I
love smoothies and I love juices and I love all that stuff. But
and again, I go back to, you know, how is it working?
How is it working for you?
Yeah.
Well, I guess I'm a perfectionist because I'd always say, no matter what I'm eating, I can always get better. You know?
Right.
So that's kind of
different. Yeah. And
we're
even in smoothies, add spices. So I like smoothies sometimes in summer and I'll recommend
it. Summertime, right?
I mean, Or if you've had a very intense workout and you're kind of feeling intense, well, cool yourself down I make smoothies and I put cardamom. I put cloves. I have the chai spice mix. I put it in my smoothie.
Ooh.
I put fresh ginger. That improves the digestibility of
the smoothie. Yeah, ginger would, wouldn't it?
Oh, ginger works great.
Fresh ginger. Juice, but
good.
But, yeah. Every day.
Yeah. There's something about eating cold food versus eating warm food. When I eat warm food, it's just like my body says yes.
Mm-hmm.
My body just
thanks
just
you.
Loves it.
Yeah. Yes, I had the same aha moment from two of my appointments yesterday.
Really?
They said, wow, warm food. I just feel better.
So,
I just feel better, they said. Yeah.
Now, funny. So what I've been doing in the morning is doing, you know, some of that coffee with ghee in it, you know, mm-hmm. and blending that up. And that's been working really well for me in the mm-hmm. mornings because it's cold and stuff. But I was just thinking the other day, I wonder if I should keep doing that throughout the summer because it's such a warm drink.
Do you want to get into a discussion of coffee?
Yeah, why not?
And then,
it's a big rage right
I want
now,
to
right?
do that. And then we also got to get back to our six. We went through the sweets. We have to revisit that.
You want to talk about the different tastes.
Well, and coffee. So let's go. Bring
again,
it on.
You know, I go back to, you know, how is it working out for you? I mean, you know, I come from South India. You know, coffee runs in our blood.
Mm-hmm. And still does? Are you still a coffee drinker?
No, not at all. Because I went through my Ayurveda program. I decided to, you know, at one point to do a cleanse. And obviously during a cleanse, you give up everything, right? You give up coffee, you give up sugar, you give up alcohol, you give up processed foods, right? You're
all
eating a mono diet, right? So, and that's when I realized that I had been addicted to a drug for many years. And it was just one cup of coffee, but it was a very strong cup of coffee in the morning that I had for years, right? Mm. And again, I grew up, I mean, my grandfather would... He had a little old German coffee mill. My grandmother would roast coffee beans.
A little old German coffee mill.
Yeah, he would powder it.
Mm.
And the whole house would smell of coffee, you know. So it's very much in our culture and tradition.
And that probably feels very nostalgic and very like...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, and I understand it for other people as well. It's the same, you know. These traditions are very dear to us.
Right.
Right.
They get passed down through the generations. Right.
But, and so it was very difficult, but... When I did my cleanse, I realized I had been addicted to a drug because I was having severe withdrawal symptoms, quote-unquote withdrawal
symptoms.
What
were they? Were they the shaky?
Headache, really bad headache, feeling irritable, feeling drowsy, lethargic, low energy.
Mm.
And that's when I decided to research on coffee. And I think I may have come across something that I spoke about Dr. John Gilead, you know. He has these lovely videos, you know. Coffee, I think it was the good, the bad, and the Ayurvedic, you know,
that's
viewpoint.
That's a great name for a book.
Yeah, the good, bad, and the Ayurvedic viewpoint. And I found like, you know, coffee is very much, yes, it's one of the most abused, you know, quote unquote drugs in the world.
It's legal, which is scary.
And it's an energy thief. You know, it doesn't have energy to give you per se, like, you know, ginseng or ashwagandha, which is like the Indian ginseng. Those are herbs. You know, revered, you know, have been revered for centuries. But yeah, coffee is an energy thief. It borrows from the future. It makes your body more acidic.
Mm-hmm. It borrows
and
from
disease,
the future.
You know, thrives in an acidic body. Health thrives in an alkaline body. It also is not good for what we call vata and pitta emotions, the worries, the anxiety, the insomnia.
Okay.
Or the irritability, being critical, being on edge. Mm. And, you know, this was when I was still in the corporate world. I'd still had one foot in the corporate world as I was going through my Ayurveda studies. So, and that made, you know, that made sense. And after the third day, I felt like a new person.
3 days.
It took a while. You know, after the third day, I felt so much more in control of my emotions. And I was having some insomnia and, you know, that kind of went away. I just felt better. And I felt a freedom of no longer being addicted to something.
Mm.
You know, I remember, you know, early morning meetings at, you know, in my corporate world.
Oh, yeah.
Were difficult for me without my cup of coffee. It was almost like I need that cup
Your
of crutch.
Coffee.
Yeah. So yeah. I just feel freer. Mm. And, you know, so I always say, see how it's working out for you.
Yes.
Okay. And now I'll have it as a treat and truly enjoy it without any guilt. So sometimes I'll go to J.C. Bean's or, you know.
And you'll let yourself indulge.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you affected by it?
Not really. Not because I'm not no longer addicted to it, mm-hmm. right? So it's just an enjoy. Yeah. But I do. I'm very mindful. And by the way, Ayurveda just is a mindful way of living. Mm-hmm. I'm very mindful. Mm-hmm. And I try to, you know, maybe antidote it with lots more water as well. It's mm-hmm. also dehydrating.
Yeah.
It's a diuretic.
Right.
Yeah. So I always say, yeah, see how it...
How it's working.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because the coffee thing is such a big thing right now. Justin's mm-hmm. been doing that bulletproof coffee kind of thing mm-hmm. where you add in the fats and you don't feel shaky. You don't mm-hmm. feel... Well, you just feel good on it.
I'm really sensitive, so I can mm-hmm. feel... Sure. So I, you know, when I first started with the mm-hmm. coffee, I tried different amounts mm-hmm. and... So right now I can do no more than 6 ounces.
He knows his very stress good. Level. And that's
a, yeah, I have people wean away from coffee. Yeah,
yeah mm-hmm. I measure it out and I do it in the morning, mm-hmm. and I add the fats to it. Mm-hmm. And it seems to be doing. You know, we went on vacation recently for a few days, and mm-hmm. I didn't have it. It wasn't. It's not anything.
It's not an addictive.
I don't really have that kind of addiction to it.
There you go. Then that's.
I drink a ton of water throughout the day with uh-huh. minerals in it and stuff. Sure. And so I exercise a lot. So it mm-hmm. seems to be my sleep is great mm-hmm. and my digestion's pretty good. Mm-hmm. So
it's probably not affecting you too much.
May no.
Yeah. Why do you drink it?
Just because I really, it's just a delivery tool. I want to get mm-hmm. the ghee. And I don't want to just put the ghee in my mouth.
Like butterscotch?
Butterscotch. So I want the ghee. I want the healthy fats. I want the coconut oil. And we cook with ghee, we cook mm-hmm. with it, you know, and stuff, but I just want more of those medicines. I'll put like a mushroom tea in there.
Got it.
So okay. I want to, really it's kind of like a superfood drink.
Yeah.
Superfood drink.
Yeah. So, and it's hot and mm-hmm. it seems to be working.
I will tell you though, and those are all good reasons. What you guys are giving me today, this wonderful tulsi tea, mm-hmm. holy basil revered in India. Ghee goes great with this too. So this is something you could try. And tulsi is such a wonderful adaptogenic herb and great for circulatory system.
I do love tulsi.
Yeah.
Would I just blend that in or melt it in?
Probably melt it in.
Oh, just, you know, take a spoon of ghee and
A dollop of ghee.
What's that? A dollop of daisy or something? Yeah, hey, whatever just works. Kind of mix it in to the warm. Yeah, the ghee will dissipate.
So much. It's yeah. so good.
Oh, ghee is a golden elixir in Ayurveda. Mm. Yeah. So, yeah.
So that is revered as a powerful...
Oh, absolutely. It's wonderful. It's, you know, it's clarified butter. Mm-hmm. It's butter without all of those artery clogging...
lactose
milk solids. Yeah.
Milk solids, yeah.
Casein. Yeah, yeah.
Does it have casein in it or no?
I don't think it does.
It's just pure fat, right? Because butter is not theoretically pure fat. It's... Mm-hmm. It's like 98% fat or something, mm-hmm, but mm-hmm. ghee is like 100%.
100%. So actually, I made ghee last week, and so
You make your own.
Oh, well, I mean,
you make everything.
You melt the ghee slowly, and you say mantras, you know, you chant. Just to infuse the ghee.
You put the love into it.
Yeah, because, you know, it's going to be the, you know, fat for, you know, a lot of your... cooking, you know, for the month or 2 months, however long it lasts.
I've heard of people doing herbs in their ghee and all kinds
mm-hmm.
of
things. Medicated ghee, medicated oils, absolutely. We have a process of cooking herbs, very much so.
I think it's beautiful what you just touched on, the lovely part of putting the intent and the mantra.
Yes.
Because my friend turned me on to hand sewing, and we've been sewing garments. Uh-huh. And there's this particular woman named Alabama Channon who has her whole thing online. But she does this thing where you love your thread. Uh-huh. You put your thread through your needle, and you just run it through your fingers, uh-huh. and you love it, and you say prayers, and you say mantras before you sew.
Yes.
And there's something about the creation of this
Absolutely.
Garment that is just infused with love, and especially when it's a gift. Oh, and it's really like cool. when people do the prayer quilts when they're, you know, for someone who has chemotherapy or with every single thing, but it's loving your thread, it's loving your ghee, it's infusing real life, right, into
absolutely
all areas of life.
Everything, we call it sadhana, making any experience sacred.
Oh, how do you spell that? I love that.
Sadhana, S-A-D-H-A-N-A.
Oh, I love that.
You know, before cooking, you know, saying a prayer. you know, yeah. while cooking, chanting, you know, while eating mindfully. Mm. Everything becomes a sadhana, sacred experience.
It's funny, in Western culture, I feel like a lot of people are like, let's say grace, doesn't mean anything, and then dig in. And it's supposed to be this, like, prayerful, mindful.
Right. Every bite should be that.
Every bite.
And every bite. Chewing food well. Both from a digestion, helping digestion. And being more mindful.
Because
that is so strange. I never really thought about that. When you pray before a meal, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that.
It's a funny concept, though, when you're like...
But you pray, and then the prayer's done. All right, let's eat.
Let's eat. Uh-huh. It's Thanksgiving. Right. Hurry up, let's bless the food. And now everybody that's kind of a strange thing.
Right. I mean, in Ayurveda, as Dr. Halpern, the director of a college, would say, how you eat is more important than what we eat. So, you know, I give specific guidelines for healthy eating, saying a grace or prayer, or just taking 3 breaths, eating without distractions, eating without negative thoughts, you know.
Chewing.
Are you pressed chewing well?
Yeah, that's a big one, isn't it?
Oh, it was a big one for me.
Yeah, I'm still working on it.
You know.
Every day.
I was like a vacuum.
I come from the corporate world. I mean, you know, some days I would pop in Amy's entree, which
gotta
I
eat thought, fast.
Yeah, and I would eat it watching Law and Order. Mm. So I've come. I always tell people, like, you know, I say, okay, my first thing I tell people when they come to my talks is I was not born with an Ayurveda spoon in my mouth entirely. Yeah. So. And I say, if I can follow Ayurveda, so can you. So and then you start enjoying. It's you and your meal, the sacredness of it. You know, we call this the body temple, right? Mm. So kind of
treat
it
like
You think about how most people eat and how, I mean, we all eat like that from time to time. We mess up and we eat like that and eating on the car and all this stuff. But you think about just the average person and the actual substance of their food itself, plus the negative thoughts, plus the way they're eating.
Right.
And then they're in the car and they're getting...
Eating on the go.
And, you know, it's just a cascading thing. And so you do that over a number of years. And just that act of eating itself alone can be a cause
of disease.
Problems. Yeah.
Absolutely.
I mean, it makes a lot of sense.
Absolutely. We all lived Ayurvedically, I want to say, you know, 3, 4, 5 generations ago, right? We all grew up on the farm, you know, woke up with the sun.
Went to bed with the dark.
What happened?
I know we've got all these, you know, now you get kiwis from New Zealand and butternut squash in spring from Mexico.
What do you think about that, foods?
I was going to ask you, what happens like a butternut squash? Uh-huh. Say you're eating it in the middle of summer or whatever. Uh-huh. Is it just that it's not helping your temple and helping you heal? Or is it actually doing damage by eating the wrong foods in the wrong seasons?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want people to get too caught up by that. You know, if you enjoy something, you know, once in a while, if it's out of season, it's okay. But it's not going to serve you optimally. Let me put it that way. Mm-hmm. Nature provides us with the harvest and bounty. Nature knows best. And Ayurveda is living in harmony with nature, right? So I got asparagus yesterday. Perfect spring vegetable.
Yeah.
Perfect for cleansing and detoxifying after the hibernation of winter, so to speak.
Is it strictly a spring vegetable, asparagus?
It'll go through summer. You can also find it in fall. But in winter, you see, that's why.
I remember
a month ago, asparagus was like $7.99 a pound or something crazy because it came from somewhere else. Exactly. And we were not meant to be eating asparagus back then.
Funny.
So what about, I wonder, people eating superfoods from New Zealand and Tibet and things. I wonder if there's even though it's far away, but what, you know, what if it's the same season? Like, you know, Tibet would be, or north of the equator would be the same seasons as us.
Yeah, Mediterranean, right? Area. Yeah, and again, having, you know, small amount of superfoods like, you know,
goji berries
comes to mind, or acai or something like that. I think that's totally okay.
But just not living like that.
But not living like, like, you know, like the Hunza in Pakistan. Mm. They they live till 100 or 110. Adopting some of, but I think they also have some lifestyle practices that go to.
Might be a little different.
A little different.
A little different, right? So sure, we can, you know, adopt certain things, but we also want to be mindful of living locally and seasonally as well.
That makes a lot of sense.
I have a question too. It's interesting. A person in the chat room talked about how they love Ayurveda. So this is probably their favorite show. Mm-hmm. But they say it's so neat. They practice at bedtime the foot massages.
Yeah.
And the other kinds of things with the belly. Mm-hmm. How important are those alongside the dietary and the body type things? I mean, can you I mean, I know we're a whole person, but can it take someone to a whole other level?
Absolutely. So the recommendations we give in Ayurveda are not just diet, right? It's the five sense therapies. So we're talking, you know, customized food programs and herbal, you know, herbs as needed. Aromatherapy for the sense of smell.
Mm-hmm. That's a big one.
Color therapy for the sense of sight. Sound therapy, working with bija mantras, working with the chakras, working with affirmations. Mm-hmm. And then touch therapy.
Touch.
So I start people, or I may not start them off. Some of them I might start them, depending on the person. But, you know, second or third appointment, I'm having them do self-massage. It's called Abhyanga.
Abhyanga.
The word for oil in Sanskrit is sneha. Abhyanga. The word for love is sneha. So oiling, yes, it's the, you know, it's an act of self-love. And Ayurveda is about self-love and self-care practices. So I think that's wonderful. I mean, you know, applying oil on your body is wonderful for vata dosha, the air and ether, pitta dosha, more of the fiery type. You know,
so you have specific, this person does belly massages, and do they do that? Is that something that they would do before bed?
And the foot massage would, I don't know specifics of this person, but doing a foot massage to ground your vata and pitta is most excellent practice to do at nighttime.
Okay.
Yeah, I pretty much do it every night as well.
Do
oiling
you?
And oiling, and you can use essential oils. You can use, again, you know, base oil of sesame, jojoba, or sunflower, but you can put some lavender oil if you're having sleep issues or anxiety issues.
Do you leave the oil on while you sleep?
Or absolutely. You and you put a sock on.
Yeah, so
it's more practical also.
Yeah, it's interesting because the nutritionist I'm working with that has helped me leaps and bounds. In my protocol, she's recommended the foot, the foot massage. She said that's a huge part. And have I done it?
You haven't done it?
No, I've done all the supplements. I've done the strict eating. I've done this, all this stuff. But there's something about that I know still calls to me. And I don't know what my problem is.
I wonder if something like that, it's interesting because it's easy to do the supplements.
Right.
But then to do some self-love, I wonder if there's something on a subconscious layer.
There you go.
That prevents you from trying to connect with really loving yourself.
I'm sure.
You
know?
Right. Absolutely.
I'm sure.
And also there can be a practical aspect. So just what helps me, I know, is having the oil on my bedside table.
Right there, ready
right
to go.
There. Ready
so
to
it's not
go.
This big old process.
Exactly.
Right.
You know, so yeah, I have, you know, part of it just for the foot massage.
How long does your foot massage last for? How long do you do it for? A couple minutes?
When I do the full body massage and, you know, what I recommend, that's a 15-20 minute
protocol. On yourself,
yeah.
That is so cool. We always look to others to give us these things.
Yeah, love, compassion starts with us, you know.
Because there's an energy probably transfer from your hands to your intention and doing everything.
Absolutely.
And, I think it's
beautiful. But the foot massage depends on the day, depends on the night, you know. Sometimes it's maybe 30 seconds. Sometimes it's a minute.
Do you skin brushing too?
Skin brushing, yes. I write article for the Chopra Center from time to time. And in fact, I'm going to, I wrote an article for, I think it was 5 or 10 spring detox tips.
Oh, nice. Okay.
Yes. And part of it, I'll repost it on Facebook, but, and I'm happy to send you the link as well. Dry brushing is great, especially in spring. But I would caution people who have very dry skin or sensitive skin just to be careful and mindful. So there are different ways. You could use loofah. You could use raw silk gloves, which are not as, I would say, harsh, abrasive.
Where do you get those?
Raw silk gloves, you can just Google those. I think I got mine on lifespa.com, which is John Duyard's website.
Lifespa.
But, you know, just Googled raw silk gloves.
Yeah, never heard of that.
Yeah, they're a little more gentle.
Oh, neat.
Yeah, and I think some facialists also recommend for face massage because they're more gentle. Yeah.
Because some things really are abrasive.
Yes, very much so, right?
Like, well, I just got a dry, you know, that little tiny brush.
Yeah, you just got one.
Two nights ago, I got a little tiny dry skin brush that says for your face. Holy moly. I used it one night. I'm like, this is intense. It doesn't feel bad on your, when you're testing it out on your body. You're like, oh, it's much softer.
Right.
I put it on my face in the shower. I thought I was just going to fall over. It was so harsh.
Well, maybe your skin needs to get used to it.
Maybe. Right. I don't know what's too harsh versus what's something you need to
right.
stick it out with. But,
right. But again, you go back to see if you get irritated skin.
Right, right. And you look like, for some signs.
Signs,
but
yeah.
The raw silk gloves just sound like
raw
heaven.
Raw silk gloves, yeah. They're really...
They sound like they would do... I'm working a lot with raw silk with my hand dyeing. I've been into organic dyes.
Wow. I have to see your work. That sounds amazing.
No, by no means have I perfected anything, but I'm having so much fun working with different textures and things.
Wow.
And the raw silk, it's so amazing to... There's this nubby yumminess.
Right?
It's real earthy.
Yes.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah. I've always... Raw silk is one
raw
of
silk
my
is
favorite
awesome.
You know, textiles. Yeah.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. I love it.
But I would say, you know, so just so that they don't leave the person who has a lot of, you know, dryness issues, they don't leave their skin overexposed, you know,
okay,
I would
yeah.
say, you know, after the shower, maybe, you know, again, anointing themselves with some yummy oils would be good.
Yeah, it seems like that would be good.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
It seems like doing a little bit of skin brushing combined mm-hmm. with the massage would be a great
yes.
combo, like a
yes.
1-2.
That's exactly, yeah. And I think that's what my protocol calls for. Yeah, not just leaving the skin exposed. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you work with people, as said on your bio on Skype.
Mm-hmm.
So people
yes.
all
yes.
over can...
Yeah, yesterday one of my clients was from Ohio. Yeah.
So do you have to see them?
I like to see them.
It
and
would be nice, yeah.
Yes, yes. So I can do the physical assessment. A physical assessment. So there's so many variables that go into me assessing a person's constitution.
Uh-huh.
And part of it is the physical assessment. Mm-hmm. The shape of the face, the shape of your eyes, the mm-hmm. shape of your nose, the size of your lips, and so on and so forth. So,
wow.
yes,
oh,
I would want to see them. And, you know, I want them to stick their tongue out at me so that I can evaluate their tongue. So,
So people can just get a camera and do that. And
right. I mean, and most people are familiar with Skype or
right.
FaceTime. Mm-hmm. FaceTime works
oh,
as
work.
Well.
They're sitting there sticking their tongue out of you.
Yeah.
Whatever
yeah.
works.
Yeah. And, you know, as one hat, so I wear three hats. One is of an Ayurveda practitioner. One is an Ayurveda chef and one is Ayurveda educator. So as a teacher with the California College of Ayurveda, I have students literally from all parts of the world.
Wow.
Mm. So and
what
we
a neat
to the miracle of technology via Skype.
Isn't that cool?
So I mean, amazing.
Yeah.
Even 20 years ago you couldn't do that. They would have to send you a picture.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's
I
so
mean,
awesome.
Technology is so wonderful. I mean, I Skype with my parents in India, living like
wow.
what? I don't know how many time zones away. Yeah. It just brings people closer.
Yeah, the opportunity is phenomenal.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
So. Wow. So you can put them on a program mm-hmm. and they can overcome whatever health challenges they're having, but then also,
mm-hmm.
This could be a lifestyle, hopefully a lifestyle mm-hmm. change. Where
I tell them yes.
It's a whole thing.
It's a way of living.
Mm-hmm.
From this point on, you're going to live more mindful.
Yeah.
And you're going to do things that are, you know, good for you.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to be very in tune to what's right for you and what's not so good for you.
Mm-hmm. So it
doesn't mean you don't indulge.
Right.
You gotta live, you know,
you gotta
be happy. Of course. Yeah, I say it's what you do 75 to 80% of the time that matters. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Do you find that there's a block with people, with certain people, with how they don't want to take care of themselves? Because in our culture, it seems like there's a block there.
Absolutely. Especially I see it with like busy moms, you know, who always put family first.
That seems like the worst.
First.
I know.
Yes.
You
know,
they have no time for themselves. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
And it's glorified in our culture.
Yeah.
It's the self-sacrificial.
Exactly.
You can't take care of your tribe if you can't take care of yourself.
Right. There's almost people feeling guilty and selfish for taking care of themselves. And so, you know, but
that's
I think
big,
more and...
Big issue.
Big issue. More and more people... I mean, I'm just... I have to pinch myself, really, because I truly believe Ayurveda is where yoga was in this country 15 years ago, and it's coming into its own. I have my practice in Dana Point, but I also partner with a couple of yoga studios, Be the Change and Yoga Shakti in Irvine.
Uh-huh.
And my vision in partnering with yoga studios is that they're already offering yoga, which is the sister science of Ayurveda. They're both sister science, both sides, two sides of the same coin, if you will. And if yoga studios offer Ayurveda, they become almost centers of perfect healthcare, if you will, right?
Right.
Yeah, because yoga offers the physical part and Ayurveda comes in with the diet and lifestyle. So I truly, and now more and more, so I'm called to more and more yoga teacher trainings to offer Ayurveda workshops. And I see Ayurveda, it has already grown in leaps and bounds. since I started practicing, and it continues to grow. Krista is going to Ayurveda school.
Is she really?
Yeah, she's going to CCA. Yes, she gave me the good news like 2 months ago. So,
wow.
Yeah, we have a budding Ayurveda practitioner right here in the neck, our neck of the woods.
I know, that's so cool.
Wow.
So yeah, I mean, I'm very happy with this trend. And I think people have been seeking out towards alternative or complementary methods of healthcare for a long time.
Yeah, because they want something that works.
They want something that's more way of living.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Integrative, whole life.
Integrative.
Holistic.
The thing we need to do is get people into the mindset of taking care of themselves and wanting to do that.
And empowering themselves.
Yes, is what
Ayurveda does. You know, and I'm sure other systems are more folkloric, holistic system of systems of medicine too.
Because you're right, it's so glorified in the culture for, you know, husbands to work for 12 hours a day because that's their role, and they want to succeed and grind it out, and then moms to take care of the kids all day.
Right.
It's all glorified, so we have to somehow change that.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Reintroduce people to their self.
And also redefine success.
Yes.
Absolutely. And living a good life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What does it mean?
Is it like that in India? Is it? I'm sure it's becoming more like that, right?
Yes. So India, places like India and China are emulating the West, right? So it's becoming more of a rat race.
Yeah.
You know, you see more KFCs and McDonald's, you know, every time I go there. But on the flip side, because yoga and Ayurveda are so popular here, I also see more yoga studios, more Ayurveda practitioners. I see Ayurveda programs on TV.
Mm-hmm.
A return to more natural state of living, which is how we all used to live.
Mm-hmm.
Natural foods, foods that we grew up with, foods that are grown locally, you know, minimally processed foods. So I think it's working on both ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
But definitely the corporatization. Yeah, corporatization.
Oh, corporatization.
Right?
Corporatization.
Yeah. Corporatization.
That's a hard,
word. Thank you, Justin. Yeah, you understand. Well, all the multinationals, so they have such a now big presence in places like in India and China as well. And so, yeah, people working long hours.
Uh-huh.
And we're beginning to see more and more, like, you know, conditions that we didn't see previously, perhaps.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, because I would imagine Ayurveda would also have to change, because people are, you know, people are getting vaccinations and their gut biome is changing, and so, you know, even though something was done 5,000 years ago, our guts are different. And so
Ayurveda moves with the time. That's why I call it now agey. Ayurveda shift. Ayurveda is all about what's appropriate for this person at this time and place.
Yes.
That's I love that.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so
I love that.
Do people need to go to a practitioner in order to figure out their particular dosha, or can they? Because I've seen those tests online.
Yeah, I've done those before. They're very misleading. and I tell people.
Even
Chopra
had one.
Tupac had one. I always say a little knowledge is a dangerous thing, because I did that myself. And then I'm like, okay, I got to see a practitioner, because there's so many variables a practitioner assesses. There's about, I was counting it the other day, like, you know, 70 or 80 variables that go into me determining a person's constitution and their imbalance.
Are there only three or four constitutions? There's three constitutions?
There's three constitution, but we can be a unique combination of those. So the combinations are infinite and endless.
Okay. Yeah. And you can different percentages of each
different percentages, exactly.
And I've heard recently, something I was listening to recently said that it's possible to even change doshas.
So that's where we get confused with those questionnaires. Our true nature blueprint does not change per se.
Okay.
But based on our diet and lifestyle habits, one or more of our doshas, you know, Vata, Pitta, Kapha, which are made of the five great elements,
can change.
And whenever we say they are in imbalance, we mean they're in excess, as evidenced by the symptoms.
I see.
So if somebody's presented with chronic constipation and gas and a lot of worry and anxiety in their minds, right now we will say based on their symptoms, they have an excess air and ether, or excess Vata dosha.
Okay.
So we would want to adopt a diet and lifestyle protocol to balance it out.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Huh.
Okay. Yeah. Uh-huh.
So you really want to... So people can contact you at your website, and it's Green Lotus Wellness?
Yeah, it's greenlotuswellness.com.
Green, let me look at that.
Right. Why green? Did you pick green for a reason?
You know.
But your background's yellow.
I know. And the lotus is green. Yes. Yeah. Like honestly, and my website was actually designed by an artist.
Oh.
He's a wonderful artist. His name is Michael. And
because it's beautiful.
I love the symbolism of the lotus blossom, in Hindu tradition and Buddhist tradition. It's about, this beautiful lotus transcending its murky waters.
Mm.
So, it's we too can transcend the murky waters of our ego and rediscover the divine beings that we truly are, which is truly, truly the philosophy of both yoga and Ayurveda. We are truly divine beings, and we get caught up in the Maya or illusionary nature of this world. We're caught up with our ego and we forget that, so we can transcend. So I always like the lotus. I've always resonated with the word green and the color green. It's nature.
Yeah. I know, that's
getting
one of my
back
favorite
to
colors.
Nature.
I know. Yeah. Green is awesome.
Yeah. 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 Green lotus. And I don't know if you find a green lotus in nature per se.
I wonder.
Yeah. I haven't seen one per se. Okay. But yeah. It's a,
Wow.
Yeah. So
it's gorgeous. I always wondered when I first went to your site, I'm like, I wonder why green.
Yeah.
You seem like you're very color, you're turned on to. Something that resonates with you, and I just
I like
had
what
to
you're
ask
saying
you.
Though about the
and it's vibrant,
and you are vibrant.
Oh, thank you.
You are vibrant.
Well, thanks to Ayurveda.
Thanks to
that's
Ayurveda.
That's what Ayurveda gives you. Ojas. Ojas is vibrant health. Mm.
So. Yeah, I like what you're saying. We'll discuss this after the show, but I like what you're saying about the sense of smell and the taste and the sound therapy and the color therapy and merging all those together. I really like that.
Meditation, yoga, books.
Yeah,
I give specific books because
that's
on
almost kind of like
interest.
Your self love, right?
It
spending
is
some time with something you're interested in.
Absolutely. I mean, that's one of the things I ask in my questionnaire is creative activities. What do you love to do?
Yeah.
And how can we make time for you to spend some time
doing that?
Yeah, doing that. Yeah, like for you, it sounds like it's making these beautiful garments.
It's really important to me right now, and I realized when the last few months have been hard with extra work and things, and I'm like, no, this is I put my foot down the other day. I'm like, nope, this is what I'm doing. I'm carving out time, and I've felt so much better since I've started again.
Yeah, I did something very similar last week. I got back to painting.
Loved
to paint. Used to paint. So, and I had gotten away for so long. And last week, I became very productive. I churned out 3 paintings.
Wow. So when you're on, you're on. That's how I am with my craft.
Yeah.
I feel like it's just such a big part of fulfilling our soul.
Fulfilling our soul. Exactly. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Getting the creative juices flowing.
Yes.
So, which helps us in other areas. Right. Right. So.
I like ping pong.
Oh, do you have a table?
We're going to get
one. We will.
We are so on when you're, because I love to play. Yeah.
Next time we do let's do another show, and next time we'll play ping pong.
All right. Okay. Yeah.
I love
it's
ping
been
pong.
A while, but yeah, I love it.
Oh, that's great.
Ping pong is great.
Isn't that so much fun?
You do love it.
I love ping pong.
You know what? If anything, it makes you laugh.
Of course,
and sometimes
yeah.
getting out of your head, I'm such a very in my head person.
Right.
It does. It makes me crack up, and it's fun playing against somebody like you who is just wild man on the table. But we should let's get our ping pong on.
Yeah.
Get our game on.
If you're willing to, we should do some more shows because we'd like you to be the resident Ayurvedic practitioner.
Oh. Love to be honored to, but first of all, this has been so much fun. I'm having so much fun here, guys.
Cool.
You guys
you.
Are wonderful. Well, you guys are really wonderful.
We love having you. You are welcome anytime.
Well, I'm just fascinated by Ayurveda, and I think it's something that everybody should look into. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of people out there saying, eat these foods, don't eat these foods, and making these sort of generalized blanket statements to all these people.
And there are fads,
fads, the coffee thing, and all this stuff. And I like Ayurveda because it really hones in on the person.
Right.
And it's a lifestyle about self-love. And I mean, that's just so great.
I think
what this whole thing
these
is
conversations and this information is, it feeds people's souls. And that's what we need. That's why we do this. And that's
I love that you guys do this. Yeah.
Well, it's important because people around us are dying, not only physically, but people are dead to themselves.
Right.
And it's when you see a spark in somebody.
Right.
That they never thought they could uncover.
Right.
That's why we all do what we do.
Absolutely.
And it's just, you see it in your eyes. You see it in what, the people that we have on our show.
Yeah.
And we're all in this together. So it's just a beautiful journey.
Yeah. And I think I'm sure you guys echo this. So grateful to be able to do what we are able to do, right?
It's an opportunity of a lifetime.
So amazing.
Yeah.
That we can even do have this conversation and you can do your work
on a Friday morning.
On a Friday morning.
Hey guys, 8 years ago, you would have found me in my Irvine office in front of the computer or maybe in a meeting.
And right.
Again, I have the greatest respect for all my corporate experiences. It's just made me a better person. It's, you know, brought a professionalism to my business that I perhaps may not have had. So I have the greatest respect. And it paid for a lot of my Ayurveda schooling. So I'm very grateful.
So you have to, you have to
very grateful, but would I rather be doing this on a Friday morning?
Of course.
Absolutely.
Well, that's the same way.
It's just an honor.
So I used to work corporate and did hair. And,
And here we are.
All right, so we should let you go because you have people to see. But people want to get a hold of you. It's greenlotuswellness.com.
That's right. And there's a contact me there. They can send me a message.
And then they would connect up with you and do a Skype consultation. You can work with them.
Yeah, or if they're in the area, you know, have them come on over. Yeah.
And I have to say, between LA and San Diego, we're in a prime place for having people travel through.
Oh, yeah. And I've people come from LA and San Diego. So, yeah.
It doesn't surprise me.
We do schedule appointments on weekends when the traffic is not so bad. So people are spending like 3 hours.
Right. It undoes all the work we just internally did to calm ourselves.
Do you do any work with people teaching them how to cook the recipes and stuff?
Oh, I do. I have cooking classes. Last time I had 8 cooking classes, 7
so
of them
can
oh,
learn
yeah.
How to do this.
Yeah. Okay. If they want to get on my distribution list, they can sign up on my website and then, you know, I inform them.
Where do you do your classes at?
I do it a variety of places. Spice Merchants in Laguna Beach.
Okay.
Savory Spice in Corona Del Mar.
Oh, wow.
I did a class last time at Teaspoons, which is a cooking school in San Juan Capistrano.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah. And then I do it at my home and then I do it at people's homes. I did, you know, 2 or 3 cooking demonstrations with families in Laguna Beach. So, yeah, so it depends on what the person is looking for. Wow. So, yeah.
To attend one.
Group cooking classes are so much fun.
Oh, they are so much fun.
You should film those. And make
I know. You know, my goal this year is to put some videos of, you know, showing people how to make ghee and khichdi and stuff like that.
Because we buy the ghee, but if you can make it, more attention.
However, we can help you, too, filming and things. We can us know.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. No,
we're in it together.
That's definitely something I'm interested in.
And we'll play ping pong, too.
And we'll play ping pong.
Ping pong sounds like so much fun.
Doesn't it?
Get our spoons of ghee in our mouth and ping pong it out.
Yeah, that'll give us the energy.
Which we're going to burn through.
Right.
Very quickly.
Right.
Okay, so it's greenlotuswellness.com if you guys are interested. And also, Kate was kind enough to take notes. So all the notes for this particular episode will be at extremehealthradio.com/422. Is that right? 422.
Yep.
So if you want to grab the show notes, you can do that. And if you know anyone else who is interested in this Ayurvedic type of lifestyle, feel free to pass the show on to them. And send it by email or Facebook or whatever.
Can I ask one quick question? This is really important. Someone is on the East Coast right now, and they ask, how would you recommend finding a good Ayurvedic practitioner? Do you know of a site for people that want to work with someone in their area?
You know, the California College of Ayurveda, they're in the process of updating their website of practitioners in their, you know, who are alums of the college.
Okay.
National Ayurveda Medical Association, NAMA, has a good directory of Ayurveda professionals.
Awesome.
I have an extensive network. So if this person, if they can send me an email, tell me where they are, I'd be happy to send them personal recommendations on the East Coast because I'm quite familiar with at least 3 or 4 East Coast practitioners.
More
in the New York, New Jersey area and Philadelphia area. So,
awesome.
Yeah.
Very
because
kind.
I also, I supervise interns through my college and they're pretty much from all over the country and all over.
Oh, okay. So they travel around.
Yeah. So then I know. Oh, okay. I have Jean Marie here. Parthenos in Florida. So I have
amazing.
Yeah.
This person says thank you very much.
Sure. So. Absolutely.
Very cool.
Yeah, that's good because people around the world will want to know.
Yeah,
and sometimes you do want to go in and see a person.
I recommend that sometimes even, I mean, like, I have somebody from, Utah, right? Right. So again, there's no practitioners in the vicinity. But sometimes I would like to maybe just do their constitutional assessment if they're in town, mm-hmm. but then maybe work with an Ayurveda practitioner
in their area. That makes
Absolutely.
Complete
that
makes sense.
Yeah, I do make recommendations for people who are like really north of LA as well in the valley.
Okay.
Yeah, because that makes more sense.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Yeah. So there's some very good practitioners in LA as well. Like, so
it's
LA.
Growing.
Yeah.
It is growing. Thank God.
Yeah. So.
Awesome. Thank you, Sandhiya.
Thank you for being on today. Thank you, Justin.
Yeah, you're so welcome. So much
Thank
fun.
You so
My heart
much.
Is
what
full.
An honor. Namaste.
Namaste.
Blessings.
Thank you.
All right, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us on the live show. Really appreciate that. We'll catch you guys on the next episode. Have a great weekend, everybody.
So, Kate, before we start the outro of the show here and the break it down, I just wanted to tell people a little bit about our store. If you're a new listener and don't know about our store, we've got lots of really cool items on there. And as many of you know, I've been into alternative health and holistic nutrition since about 2003, and I've just really been involved deeply in the alternative health movement. And over the years, I've compiled some of the best, most cutting-edge products that we can find and get our hands on. And then once we get them and use them, then we put them on our store. And so on the store, we're doing our best to add new products all the time, but there's some really cool stuff. Like there's the Organifi green juice. We have a whole list of physical products that you can buy, as well as products or programs and courses that you can buy too, which are really, really great. But the physical products, what I love about them is that they're stuff that we use all the time, and they've really benefited our life. Right now, the Organifi green juice is on there, earthing mats. So if you want to ground your bed to the earth and get the benefits of grounding while you're sleeping. We've got this really cool thing called the Cocoa Jack. It's kind of a new product. It's a great way to open coconuts. We've got a really awesome Energy Muse jewelry that's infused with intention. Really cool stuff. We've got the Vitalizer Plus. So if you guys are interested in spinning and vortexing your water, we've got grounded sandals. We've got so many cool things. I really love the Berry Breeze. We have the Berry Breeze in our refrigerator. And it helps to put out oxygen into your fridge so your food lasts a ton longer. We've also got organic CeramCore Extrema cookware, free of heavy metals, free of chemicals, free of toxins. Because, you know, a lot of us get heavy metals from the cookware that we cook our food on. We've also got olive leaf extract activation products, which has got some really great magnesium and Ocean's Alive marine phytoplankton. We've got Morocco Method hair care products, which are really great. We've had Anthony Morocco on the show. We've got the Biomat. If you guys don't know what the Biomat is, go onto our store and you can watch some videos on it. Super cool. We have the small version. A lot of people ask us what version of that we have. And then also we have, you know, face and body balms. We've got some, you know, stuff for your face and beauty care products. We've got raw dog food for your dog. We've got Anne-Marie Gianni skincare, living libations products, all their essential oils. We've got products from Less EMF. We've also got as well our sauna, our rebounder. Now, if you guys haven't tried the sauna or the rebounder, those are my go-to, daily tools that I use every single day. The sauna I just got out of, in fact, for about 40 minutes. And sweating is one of the best ways to detoxify your body of chemicals, toxins, poisons, pollutants that we breathe in the air. It's a great way to get rid of those through the pores of your skin. Saunas are awesome. I use mine every day. I have done so for about 3 years now. I usually pop in a documentary and have spa day with Justin. It's super cool. The rebounder is great too for building your bone density, improving your lymphatic system. It's a cellular exercise, so it stimulates every single cell in your body. We've got such good stuff on our store. I'm telling you guys. We've got the Berkey water filtration system. We've got stand-up desks, the Excalibur dehydrators. We've got blenders, the Vitamix and the Blendtec, as well as the Austin air purifier. Got a great Qigong program that I use every single day. Really, really cool stuff. And what is super popular lately, a lot of you guys have been buying the Squatty Potty, which is a stool you put underneath your toilet. And it's really great for, it helps to unkink your lower colon so that you expel your bowel movements much more effectively and easily. preventing hemorrhoids and eventually, perhaps, maybe colon cancer. We don't know yet. That's not proven, but it's a really great tool. And I've also got the One More Way raw vegan protein powder. I'm sorry, it's not raw. It's not vegan. It's raw, but not vegan. Coming from grass-fed Amish farms, cows, really great stuff. One of the only raw, one of the only raw whey protein powders I know about. So anyway, we've got some really cool stuff on our store. Please go check it out. And anytime you are going to be making any purchases in the alternative health space, check out our store first, because we affiliate to a lot of these companies and we support what they do. And that's how we are able to do this show for free. So go check those out. And there you have it. Sandhiya Ramaswamy.
Are we on?
We're on.
Great name.
Hey, I've been thinking about something she said.
What?
What did she mean when she said that coffee borrows from the future? Was that?
Yeah, I don't know.
That was interesting.
The conversation went so fast, I couldn't really soak that in, and we moved on. But coffee borrows from the future.
Have you heard that thing about raw food and cooked food? How they say cooked food represents the past and raw food represents the present.
I haven't heard that actually.
Typically raw food is more something, you know, cooked. I'm sorry, raw food is more uncooked, so it's something you have to eat fresh.
Uh-huh.
So it represents being in the moment.
Right, that would make sense.
And cooked food represents the past, you know.
It's dead.
It's dead, yeah, it's dead in the past, you know, like just living in the past and in your head and all that.
So all people who eat cooked food only are dead. Is that what you're saying?
Pretty much.
Can I quote you on that?
That would include us too.
Right.
But I thought that was interesting. Coffee
borrows from the future?
Borrows from the future. Didn't know what that meant. She didn't seem too keen on coffee.
Kind of, but she didn't seem anti either. Mm-hmm. I mean, she said occasionally she goes through and grabs a cup of the local brew.
Yeah.
I think that's fine. I think the way you do it, you were talking about how you just, you know, when we were off the air and after we said goodbye to her, we talked a lot in the kitchen and you were talking about how you're kind of fancying your stuff up with the coffee. You're not trying to just get as much coffee as you like. You're not drinking it out of habit and you're not drinking it out of addiction. You're doing it because of what you believe could be some pretty good, you know, colon cancer fighters and things like that.
Yeah.
And you're only doing 6 ounces and you're putting all this like bulletproof style stuff around it. So you're not getting shakes. You're not getting
the shimmies.
The shimmies. The shakes and the shimmies. You always say that. Where did that come from? You're the first person I've ever heard in my life say that. The shakes and the shimmies. You're like an old man. The shakes and the shimmies.
Just got the shakes and the shimmies. Yeah, I'm not doing like black straight coffee because I'm tired and I have to wake up kind of thing.
Yeah. And you're not working a miserable corporate job where you have, you know, 12 hours to make it through and you're drinking like 2 pots of coffee.
Right.
I mean, I think that's the difference. She didn't sound anti. It just didn't sound like it added to people's present conditions, you know, like in her opinion.
Now you can't.
Borrows from the future.
Borrows from the future.
I wonder if that just means you're depleting, because I know it dehydrates you and it sucks. It messes with your adrenals.
Uh-huh.
And if you're messing with your adrenals, it throws everything off. Maybe she's talking about like a longevity type thing. Maybe. I don't know. I'll have to ask her about that.
Yeah.
I'd like
to. You can't do any coffee these days, can you? Can you do decaf?
I don't do well with coffee. I can do anything I want.
That's right. You can do anything you want.
No. Mm-hmm. I get very, very shaky even with decaf.
I can't believe you used to drink as much as you did.
Oh, and decaf kind of scares me now, knowing the process. You know, you hear a lot of...
Yeah, what did Andrew say about decaf? There's more chemicals in the decaf, isn't there?
Yeah, the way it's processed to get it, to get the caffeine out of it.
Wow.
It's like the non-fat whole milk debate, you know? It's like you're better off probably drinking the regular whole milk than you are. Or the low-fat diet. I mean, a lot of, you know, things in the grocery store that say low-fat are going to have all these other problems with them. So
I wonder
know.
If it's possible to even have organic decaffeinated coffee, because
I don't know.
Doesn't sound like it, because if you need to have chemicals to make it decaf, then you wouldn't be able to have organic decaf. That's weird.
Yeah, organic decaf. The only kind of coffee that I've done in the last few months is coffee enema.
Oh yeah,
with the best coffee, the most raw coffee S.A. Wilson's?
S.A. Wilson's.
Yeah, that's been great.
Raw coffee beans.
Ooh, it's green. It's like a green-yellow powder, and that's something to write home about.
Oh, man.
But, yeah, no, I used to drink so much coffee. But that's the thing, though. I wanted to be a coffee person and drink straight up coffee with just a little bit of cream and sugar and kind of stuff.
You wanted to be...
I wanted to be a coffee house girl.
A coffee house girl, like in Friends, and it's raining outside, and...
I'm over here rolling my eyes. I like it. You're telling me what I wanted to be. The romance of it all. No, yeah. I mean, remember when coffee shops came out, though?
Oh, they're huge.
It's just, it was such a romantic kind of a place to be. And
yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I used to love is I used to love those...
Frappuccinos.
Coffee shakes that they used to have at Diedrich's.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're just like a frappuccino. They're so good.
But you know what you can do? We got to buy one of those little things on Amazon, the whipped cream maker that you can make with coconut fat.
Mm-hmm.
Make the
straight
whipped
up coconut whipped cream.
Oh man, a little bit of stevia and vanilla.
Mm-hmm. I can't whistle. I don't know whose was better.
I compensated. The one no wonder.
I feel the one no wonder. I feel like consciously, I like that.
Yeah, awaringly.
I consciously made a choice to drink coffee all those years, though, like lattes.
Uh-huh.
And they were mostly milk, a little bit of coffee, but it was a sprayed espresso shot with the milk. I would get shaky from those. A decaf shot of espresso with mostly milk. I drank that for years when I was doing hair. There was a Starbucks right in the plaza, and I'd have one, if not two, a day.
Oh, my God.
And they were like my little treat for, you know, going to work. And wow. I could see it as a reward system for sure. Like, I could see that about anybody who goes home and drinks, you know, wine. It's like you think all day you deserve something. And that was my thing at the time. And I felt horrible every time I drank one. I felt bloated. I felt shaky.
So I kept doing it.
Oh, yeah. And sugared out because I'd have like a squirt of like the toffee nut syrup in there. I'd have whipped cream on it. Oh, my gosh. Then when I found out what was in those pumpkin lattes, I remember hearing something about how there was like no pumpkin in a pumpkin latte.
Yeah.
Even when I was into coffee, and that kind of scared me.
Because why are they calling it that? That's so bizarre.
Right. When I found out, like the food babe did a lot of stuff on this whole, she debunked a lot of this, what is in the latte, and broke it apart. And
that was a whole lot of
pretty eye opening.
Not
a whole lot of chemicals, whole lot of fake pumpkin products, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we'll get off the coffee thing. But the other interesting thing I always thought is when I've gone in to buy someone a gift card at Starbucks or meet someone for a tea or something, mm-hmm. which has probably been a few times in the last like 5-7 years, I reek of coffee. I come out of that place and my car, if I'll drive home, the car smells like coffee for 2 days. Mm-hmm. Everything, my clothes smell like coffee. Just being in the coffee shop, it's really, really, it bothers me. It's bothersome. Mm-hmm. It's a strange, weird, why is that clinging on me? And I remember when I used to drink that coffee, and this might be too much information, but we talk about everything on the show.
Why not?
Whenever I'd pee, it just reeked of coffee all the time. Like when I pee, my pee always smelled like coffee.
Wow.
So do you, when you drink coffee, do you smell?
I mean, I don't think so. I don't
crazy?
Smell anything. Yeah.
And don't feel shaky at all.
I don't feel, it was really a science because I tried to do 10 ounces or 12 ounces and then I had to go back. And so I finally figured out that 6 was my magical number. Uh-huh. But then I do fats like I do with the ghee and the coconut oil and stuff. So I do fats, a lot of other things in there. Any real coffee aficionado would probably
call that coffee.
Yeah, look at the drink I make and just laugh. But to me, it's more about getting the antioxidants and things. So uh-huh. I don't really think I smell.
Mm-hmm. Well, you'd know if you peed and your pee smelled like coffee so much, though.
I love it, though.
It's coffee's amazing.
Yeah, I never was into it.
What do you... You're a really late bloomer. I love it.
Yeah.
What do you think of the whole Ayurveda in general? Like, could you get into the whole basmati rice thing?
Because
we haven't done rice in a long time, and I know that...
Were you saying today that you're going to get some brown rice?
I want to try some brown rice again.
Should we get the basmati or what? I don't know anything about rice, really. I know that they say wild rice. That's why I asked her why mm-hmm. wild rice is really like a superfood. Daniel Vitalis talks about that, but I don't know anything about
basmati,
or I don't really know much about the rices that much. But
I do know they're low in sulfur.
They're low in sulfur.
So for people like me who can't have high thiol foods, rice is supposed to be okay. according to, gosh, I'll put a link to the...
Even white rice?
Even white rice, any rices, which is really strange.
Really?
From my knowledge of this article. We'll have to put, I'm writing myself a note to link to sulfur article, or sulfur list.
Hey, I have a little food combining thing here for this that's regarding Ayurvedic.
Okay.
I just found this article today, so I figured I'll share it. So this is an article called Ayurveda's List of Incompatible Foods.
Ooh.
Things that don't go together.
Everything I eat.
So milk is incompatible with bananas, cherries, melons, sour fruits, bread containing yeast, fish, and here's that word again,
Khichri? Yeah.
What is that?
I don't know, but she kept talking about it, and I felt like an idiot rambling on, not knowing how to read that word when I was reading someone's email.
Yeah, I think they said that in the chat room, right?
Yeah.
Meat and yogurt. Why would milk not be incompatible with yogurt? Because yogurt's really just essentially a fermented milk,
I don't know.
So honey
is
incompatible with ghee.
Okay.
Which is, that's it, just ghee.
Okay.
Yogurt is incompatible with fruit, cheese, eggs, fish, hot drinks, meat, milk, and nightshades.
Wow.
So fruit is incompatible with, as a rule, with any other food. So there are exceptions such as certain cooked combinations as well as dates and milk, which have the same rasa, vira?
Oh, I would totally fail this Ayurvedic word.
And vipaka.
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 Never heard of it. Chewbacca.
Grain is incompatible with fruit and tapioca.
Grain?
Uh-huh.
Okay. I don't know why anyone would ever decide to put a grain with tapioca, but okay.
Well, I mean, maybe you have, like, all you have if you're at home one night is tapioca and bread. You're stuck at home with tapioca and bread. Hot drinks.
I have a sardine and I have some honey. Whoever figured this out. Hot drinks and what?
Incompatible with mangoes, cheese, fish, meat, starch, and yogurt. So number 7.
Okay.
Radishes. Incompatible with bananas, raisins, and milk.
Again, weird.
I know, right? Who's?
Okay.
Beans are incompatible with fruit, cheese, eggs, fish, milk, and yogurt.
Oh, the Mexicans have a big problem then.
Yeah, why?
You think of all the bean burritos and the Mexican cooking, it's cheese and beans right there.
Cheese and beans.
Always.
Cheese, eggs, fish.
And eggs and bean burritos, like those morning burritos.
Those are so good when I was a kid.
Oh, I love it. I love Mexican food.
Oh, bean burritos.
Whoa, okay.
So eggs are incompatible with fruit, especially melons, beans, cheese, fish, khichri, milk, meat, and yogurt.
I don't even know if I'm saying it right, but that's what I remember her saying.
Lemon is incompatible with milk, tomatoes, and yogurt.
That makes sense with the acids, maybe?
Yeah.
Maybe?
Okay.
What else you got?
Let's see here. Tapioca is incompatible with fruit, especially banana and mango, beans, raisins, and what is jaggery? J-A-G-G-A-R-Y.
Never heard of it.
Don't know about it. That's
jaggery.
It.
With Mick Jagger?
Tapioca doesn't mix with Mick Jagger. That's part of the... We don't mix with Mick.
I think we should come up with our own list. They could all be things like that.
Completely like in...
Succulents don't mix with
foam rollers.
Toyotas. Foam
roller. Yeah, interesting though. I think in general, I like the Ayurvedic idea.
Yeah.
I think that...
I have to say, it's one thing I haven't tried yet.
Fully like immersed ourselves in
no,
it.
No, I have not.
I haven't either. I've played with it. But I mean, just like that, you know, this morning when we had her on and I had... melons for breakfast, or what was it?
Papaya
for breakfast.
Oh, and mango, you said.
Mango, mango. And it was cold, and then I could feel some inflammation in my throat and some mucus, and I'd clear my throat a lot. And then as soon as I had that tea that you made, that warm tea, it just felt like it all went away. I mean, there's something about the warmth of food.
Yeah.
You know?
I wonder what, I know it's a seasonal kind of an eating though. So, I mean, is that saying in summer you don't have warming foods for breakfast? Like she said, there's a time when you can bring smoothies and fruits and things in, but I have to think for a whole season, that doesn't seem good on your digestion first thing in the morning to do cold, cold items.
Yeah.
Because you're hot. it seems like if you're hot, your body's hot, and you're throwing a bunch of cold stuff in, it just seems like, doesn't seem like your body changed. I mean, it might change with the seasons, but I can't imagine you eat hot, warming, comforting foods the rest of the year, and then in summer you just throw a bunch of cold things first thing in the morning in your system. I don't know. I have a lot to learn. Well, I'm fascinated by it.
I like the idea of doing, like, we don't put our water in the fridge anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's just, to me, it's too much of a shock.
Mm-hmm. Or your papaya when you have that, or mango.
Yeah. Room temperature fruit I really like.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, especially, you know, there's nothing better than, like, blackberries that are warm in the sun.
Yum. Pick them right off fresh. The vine.
Oh, isn't that good?
Yum.
Man.
Anything right off a vine or a tree or a branch or out of the ground is so good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that I've heard that when your food is cold, or especially drinks, and you put that cold right in your body,
mm-hmm.
your body needs to use extra energy to bring the temperature of the food to your body temperature.
Okay.
Because eventually, if you drink cold water, freezing cold water, eventually...
That makes sense.
It becomes, if it's sitting in your stomach, it's going to become the same temperature you are.
Right.
So in order for it to do that, your body has to... make it, you know, turn it to assimilate it into the temperature that your body is, like 98.6 or whatever.
Okay.
So in order to do that, it needs to use energy to do that. So when you eat colder food, you're going to rob your body of energy, at least according to this.
I just thought of a really bad combo then.
Uh-oh.
Of eating like
ice cream,
frozen cold ice cream, uh-huh. coconut ice cream or whatever, and then laying in the float tank. Because Why? The float tank water is already the temperature of your body, and everything's like, it'd have to bring up this freezing cold thing in your right. stomach.
Mm-hmm.
That would be an odd, it seems like really bad combo, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. It does.
Maybe that's why you've had a little interesting time floating in the past, right after you have a smoothie.
Have I? Was it a smoothie or?
I don't know. I'm just thinking you don't do well when food's in your stomach.
When I float?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
When you float. So I'm wondering if it had anything to do with the temperature of the food. I don't know.
Probably. It could be.
I don't know.
Are you willing to, are you going to play around with the Ayurvedic diet?
Yeah. And I'd love to have I would really honestly love to have an appointment with her
mm-hmm.
and have her. It fascinates me when people spend so much time on you, breaking down the things that make you you.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at your tongue, spending time looking at your eyes, the structure of your face, the size of your lips. I think all that stuff is really important. And I would just love to know, like, what my face and my features and my predispositions are.
Yeah.
So that I can know. I don't know. I'm on such a specialized diet right now and such
you?
A...
No.
I know. So I don't know. I mean, I'd like to say I'm drawn to Ayurveda.
Yeah.
Will it make me feel bad at the beginning doing, like, the basmati rice and doing, like, a cleanse of sorts? Maybe, and I take into consideration what we talked about with Meridian Grace, you know, on our last show with her, which, by the way, is a great show if no one's heard it yet.
Yeah.
Oh, what my gosh.
What episode was that?
What episode
we'll
was
put
that?
A link to it. In this.
But she talks about the four methods of basically detoxing.
Or four modes.
Or four modes, sorry, yeah. And I felt like, again, I mean, Ayurveda has been around for thousands of years and probably works really well for most people. I'd like to be one of those people. I'm open at this point to saying yes or no to anything that works or doesn't work for me, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how long you try something like that. If it goes
something like what?
Like an Ayurveda, like a rice basmati of a,
well, you know what? It may,
a cleanse.
It may not be though that you would be eating that because you know, she may get your body type and,
right.
And see other foods are better for you. You know?
Yeah, I'm really curious about it because I do have issues with lentils and a bunch of other things that seem to be very Ayurveda friendly.
Right.
So I don't know. I'd love to meet with her and find out. And I have a really big aversion to like curry and cumin and stuff like that. It seems like it's against everything that I'm naturally drawn to. Or my body does well with. But wouldn't that be funny if that's the stuff that was good for me?
Because
I've almost exhausted every other food known to man mm-hmm. so far. Except manna. And if anyone out there knows how to make manna, please let me know.
We'll contact the authors of the Bible. Get back to you very shortly.
The world's best food. I keep saying, if I could just market manna. $1 million idea.
I bet there was no food allergies back then.
I bet there wasn't. Hey, can you imagine you're the one person in the desert who can't eat manna?
I'm in anaphylactic shock when I eat manna. Yeah, that wouldn't be good.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I think that there could be something there. I think
you should list that on the next time somebody asks you, like, when to fill out paperwork.
What
are you allergic to?
Manna.
What is it? It would open up a great conversation. Yeah, I'm allergic to antibiotics, Cipro, and Manna. Okay, sorry. Go ahead.
No, I think that I think you have a lot of people out there that are prescribing particular diets for people in general, you know. And I don't know. I just think that I like the way Ayurveda is completely individualized. Mm-hmm. I think that's a huge, because I don't really see any other diets that are doing that. I mean, maybe a little bit, like the one you're on with Nikki Moses. You know, she's doing a lot of things to balance through supplementation and things. But I think that you have people running around saying that paleo diet's the best diet ever, or the raw food diet, or the vegan diet. And I think that just, what if someone needs to heal their gut first? And, mm-hmm. you know, and let's say like the vegan diet's perfect for someone, but let's say they need to heal their gut, and the only thing that will heal their gut is colostrum. You know, so maybe they need to do colostrum for a couple months, and then they can go on the vegan diet.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or, you know, just an example that, you know, there could be lots of reasons why, you know, one of the things she was talking about was how long it's been around, but we're doing such weird things to our gut these days through vaccinations and chemtrails and everything else that...
And hybridizations of foods in general, yeah. GMOs and just...
Ugh. Our gut biome is not what it was when Ayurveda was first being proliferated, so... It has to change with all the weird stuff we're doing to ourselves now, you know?
And she seemed to be speaking the same truth.
Which is cool. Ayurveda. It's flexible and it changes.
I want my biome back.
You want your biome back?
Yeah, I do. No, but she was great about that. I loved her ease in which to flow with people's individuality and changing of the times because... Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we're not 5,000, 6,000 years ago, nor are we ever going to go back to that, probably.
Right.
So we need to work with the new reality, the new dream we find ourselves in.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Yeah.
Well, that was a good show.
It was a good show.
It was fun.
Do you think that was the last one in our home studio?
Oh, maybe. We've been kind of hinting about this.
So excited.
A brand new journey for us that we've been sort of talking about for a while. Heck, sort of hinting at.
Heck.
So you want to talk a little bit about that
quick? Let's do it.
Okay.
So we signed a lease.
We signed a year lease mm-hmm. for a brand new studio, which is amazing.
I'm excited.
Never thought this would come to this. Never thought that, I don't know, that this would actually happen.
Yeah.
But we're so excited about this.
Well, why are you the most excited about it? Because I know why I am, but I'm curious to hear what your thoughts
are. We're going to be moving towards... I'm excited because it's going to allow us to grow in different areas. We're going to be moving towards live... Maybe live video, but definitely more video in our podcasts. And so it's going to allow us to get rid of a bunch of equipment that's causing us... causing electromagnetic field radiation. And so... There's a lot of radiation in this studio right now that we're trying to work around, so we're not going to have that. It's going to allow us to have a place outside the home where we can go and be quiet, and you can go write and work on your projects. And we're going to be branching out into other areas, too. I'm starting a different website that's going to be a different website along with a different podcast that's going to be more...
Oriented?
What's that?
Oriented
or focused on different areas of interest in my life, like just exploring just different people that I'm really interested in doing great things on in the world and talking about different ideas.
Just not health related?
Yeah, just not health related.
Right. You love that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I love it.
Right. And, it does seem funny, though, that there's a big crossover in general for people who are health people who are into health are usually into all these other interesting ideas too. Usually.
Yeah. I mean, look
it seems
at,
to be
look at, what's his name? What was
cross pollination?
Yeah.
Steve Maxwell.
Well, Steve Maxwell, Tony Pantelaresco,
uh-huh.
You know, he's going on and on about the chemtrails.
Oh, you're right.
You know, all this stuff. And, you know, stuff like that is really interesting to me. I'm really fascinated by ancient cultures, ancient civilizations, what man's role is on the earth, the creation story, God, spirituality, religion, economics and history and things like that. And so I'm just going to be doing a separate podcast by myself. It's going to be video based that will be interviewing a bunch of different people.
Yay.
And I'm super excited about it.
Yeah, we have the space to be able to create, mm-hmm. do these things more.
And for those that are wondering, we're still going to be doing Extreme Health Radio, so mm-hmm. don't let that
get scare your panties
you.
In a wad.
Don't get your panties in a wad.
Or scare you.
We're still going to be doing Extreme Health Radio, so
right.
Yeah, this is just going to be something on top of that.
We're able to branch and do other projects.
Yeah,
it's so exciting.
So, I want to hear what you're going to do.
I'm going to have dance parties after hours. That's why I'm excited.
1 a.m. dance parties?
Whole reason I've ever dreamt of having a studio. Dance totally. Party? No, I'm very excited to have a space that I can go to on the way to the part-time job that I work at the speech therapy right now, mm-hmm. and be able to have a quiet indoor space without any outside noise affecting me to be able to write, because I have mentioned on the show, and I will mention again, I'm slow going, but I am writing a book. Mm-hmm. Which excites the heck out of me. Mm-hmm. And I feel
any
like...
Any ideas when you want to have that published?
I want to be done writing it by the end of the year.
Done writing it. Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's probably going to take that long. It's quite a... It's, nice. I feel like it's my life's... Not only work, but a huge chunk of like my life. Like I feel like everything's leading up to this book.
Yeah.
And I started it a while ago, but it's one of those things you have to roll with, because... The minute you say yes to a project like that, it seems like everything either tries to get in the way, and or you start learning new things as you go and you realize you kind of take it a different direction than when you first had the intention.
Right.
So it's a work, and it's behind the scenes. And I think half the time people think, oh, you keep saying you're working on these things and we don't ever see them. It's because I feel like we've really had to ask ourselves what it is that feeds our soul and also brings our truth out best into the world and presents our true selves in really creative ways. And sometimes you get excited about projects and then you back off from them because your soul feels different as you go down mm-hmm. the rabbit hole. It might not, like anybody else. I mean, we've had to change our mind multiple times on things or people we've wanted to work with. Mm-hmm. And I feel like kind of like, you know, the snow globe has been shaken and now the snow is settling and exactly what we know we want. And that's right. exciting to me. So I feel like this office just facilitates, it's new energy and new space in which to create it. Because to be honest, I mean, people who have listened to our show for a long time have probably heard us complain at times, which isn't good, but talk about how much of a challenge it is to live in this apartment, because mm-hmm. we live at a four-way stop where there's just constant traffic and cars and bikes and people yelling and, you know, homeless people pushing carts outside your house when you're trying to, you know, right. record a show and Harleys and dogs. And it's really hard because to write a book, I have to go shut myself in our bedroom where we have other windows and a slider leading out to a porch where there's gardening and we have a park and construction. And it's really hard if I'm in the living room, I can't even hear anything. So this to me just represents a whole new gateway to freedom.
Right, right.
For myself and for my creativity uh-huh. to be able to flow. It's really exciting.
And you're also going to be doing something with your own site too.
I am. I'm also not leaving Extreme Health Radio.
Well, you're what?
I'm not leaving.
Nope.
I'm not, but I'm also branching out and doing my own site.
How rad is that?
I know. I'm excited and branching off and doing my own podcast.
I know, right? You're going
to
do your own podcast.
Talking to people who I want to talk to that yeah. are or are not health related necessarily. Sometimes again, those overlap and you can't help but do that, but I'm really excited about it.
That's super cool.
So, yeah. And I hope like you, I think one of our biggest hopes is to be able to have just a really easy place for people to come in studio. Mm-hmm. So we can do a lot more video stuff, because it's kind of hard to have people honestly coming into your space in your house. It's kind of like, you know, people coming and going and there's already so much going on outside. You feel like you never really get your own sacred space.
Right.
And to us, that's really important to keep those two things separate. So I feel like that's going to be a really big blessing.
That's going to be cool.
I'm excited.
I know. I'm super excited. I cannot wait to move in there. So we're working on, we ordered a brand new computer, a production PC that cost a pretty penny.
I was going to say, that's a chunk of change.
And and so we have a guy building that for us, and that's going to allow us to stream live video if we want, super high quality. We bought all the cameras, and so... Now we've got to figure out a way to pay all this stuff back.
Speaking of, if anyone feels so inclined to support us.
Yeah.
Oh, man, we'd really appreciate it with these new rising costs. And we're going out on a limb. mm-hmm. with this and trusting that it's all going to work out financially, but we can definitely use all the support you guys can give. And, you know, even a couple bucks just thrown our way through Patreon or
yeah.
through even PayPal, whatever mm-hmm. you can do. Oh man, does it help us? Because mm-hmm. yeah.
Yeah. Cause we had to shell out quite a chunk of change in order to do all this with the insurance that we had to get for the studio for a full year, special kind of insurance for all the equipment, and then the equipment itself, and then the software,
and then the monthly rental of the space.
Whew,
it's hard.
We're really going out on a limb here. So yeah, if you guys want to support what we're doing, you can do that. There'll be a link on this show page. What is it? extremehealthradio.com/422. It's called Patreon, or you can do that on PayPal as well.
Jump on the EHR train.
What's that?
You can jump on the EHR train.
I know, right? And then the other thing we're going to be doing, or I'm going to be doing too, is I'm working behind the scenes with a certain doctor, a couple different people on a site where we're going to dive deeper into remedies and ways, protocols, and having the ability to ask a doctor your health questions. And we're going to be launching a brand new website here pretty soon too. That's going to be a membership website, so you'd have to pay to get access to it. But, this is where we're going to have videos on there. We're going to show people how to do a lot of these cutting edge protocols that these doctors give their patients and their clients, instructions on how to do. But this is all going to be tutorials and how to do stuff. And we'll be talking about all kinds of really cool stuff, some really cutting edge information that you're not going to get anywhere else. And so we're going to be creating a membership site for that pretty soon. So we're going to be flying out to another state to do that, to do all the videos. So all of this requires cash.
Moolah.
Moolah.
And so, we're not all about money, but we need it to live like everybody else, or to make these projects possible. So
yeah, I'm excited for your stuff too.
Thanks.
I'm really excited for you to do your podcast and to interview people and to have cool conversations with people that you like. I think it's going to be really cool.
I think my first interview is going to be Maggie Brown Longbottom, the mind of Maggie. She's rolling around like a otter, a sea otter. Look at her.
Yeah, she's so cute. We should have video on for this one. But yeah, I'm really excited too. About your stuff. It's
going to
be really cool.
I'm vamped.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to be really fun.
New energy, springtime, spring cleaning, clear out the cobwebs of life and rooms and get going.
Yeah.
It's exciting.
It's going to be a lot of fun. Yeah, so we have a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes, and we'll be keeping you abreast of what's going on as we move forward with all this stuff. Really super exciting. And more just basically ways to put out content that's going to help you guys. So stay tuned for all of that. And if you guys enjoyed this show.
Thanks for being patient with us.
Yeah. If you enjoyed this show, please pass it on to your friends. We'd appreciate that. And if you want the show notes to anything we talked about, extremehealthradio.com/422. And that's about it, right?
Yeah, this is a great day. I love this conversation.
Yeah, it's good.
We shall continue it over a coffee snack.
Over a coffee snack. Flulaborg.
Flula. Let's put a link to Flulaborg. Is that guy still making videos?
I think so.
Is his last name Borg?
B-O-R-G, yeah.
Flulaborg. Oh my gosh. For those of you who haven't checked out Flula, you won't be sorry.
Oh, he's great. He is great. All right, guys. Thanks for listening. We appreciate it so much. Pass the show on to your friends. We would greatly appreciate that. If you want to sign up to our Facebook, you can do that. That'll be a link on our website, too. You can subscribe to our Facebook news updates. And also, if you want to sign up to our newsletter, that way you get to stay up to date with all the summits that happen. All the summits are free. We usually let people know about all the free summits that are going on. And all of our shows. And if you want to be notified of any live shows that are going on, make sure to follow us on Twitter. That's where we're going to be posting the live show. So if you want to know, if you want to catch a chat room or ask a question to a doctor, follow us on Twitter. We're not going to be posting. Sometimes we get around to posting it on Instagram, but Twitter is going to be
occasionally.
Yeah, sometimes if we have enough time to do that, but normally we'll do a Twitter update, so you'll be notified when we're going to go live with a certain guest. So that's where to do that. That's about it, right?
Yeah, I was going to say jump on the bird.
Oh, jump on the bird. One thing I do want to say, if you guys could please go to our Amazon link. We'd really appreciate if you could do this. It'd be a great way to support us. You don't have to donate, or you don't have to even share our shows or anything. But I know most people
do shop through Amazon.
Yeah, most people shop on Amazon. So if you could do us a favor, it would be super supportive for us. It'd help us a lot. If you can go to our website and click on the Amazon link that's on the right-hand side there, and then when that link opens up, if you could bookmark that link in your browser, and then anytime you make a future purchase on Amazon, if you could use the bookmark, that would help support our show. That way, because we'll get a small little percentage commission every time you make a purchase. We can't see who orders what, but it would be a great way to support the show without, you know, sending in a donation if you can't afford to do that, or if you can't, don't want to share our stuff or anything like that. It's a great way to support us.
And you still get stuff.
Yeah, you still get all the cool stuff. Nothing changes for you.
Everybody wins.
Everybody wins, and it helps us a lot. So
you could buy some basmati rice.
Basmati rice. We're going to buy that cricket flour pretty soon.
Oh, gosh, cricket flour. Yeah, we are. I'll try it. I'll try anything.
I love it.
It'd be funny if cricket flour was like just a steady diet of cricket flour was good for me.
You'd probably make bread out of cricket flour.
Oh, you think you can make anything?
Oh, pancakes.
Wouldn't it be funny when like cookies and cakes and stuff become anything but what they used to be made out of? It's like for the egg replacement, you'd have soaked chia seeds and some sort of a other thing and banana. And then, yeah, you'd have cricket flour. And pretty soon you're eating something called a pancake. But that doesn't even resemble a pancake.
That'd be pretty cool.
All
right, guys. We're rambling on now. Appreciate it so much. We love all you guys. Thank you for listening and passing the show on and bookmarking Amazon and all that.
And we will catch you guys on the next episode.
Hey, everybody. This is Josie, Justin's mom. Don't tell him, but I know he would absolutely be really happy if you would sign up to his free weekly newsletter. And don't forget to share this with all your friends. This is the buzzing bumblebee signing off.
That was so good.
Hello.
Oh my gosh.
No material on this blog is intended to suggest that you should not seek professional medical care. Always work with qualified medical professionals, even if you educate yourself in the field of live food, nutrition, and alternative medicine. I'm not a doctor, nor am I offering readers medical